Good afternoon. I am David Clark, and I am chair of the American Bar Association Standing Committee on Gun Violence. We hope you will find this program today, presented in conjunction with the Office of the Mayor of Philadelphia, to be timely and useful. With gun violence continuing to be such a terrible problem in our country, much worse here than in the rest of the developed world, people continue to ask what, if anything, can be done about it. You know, I grew up in a home with guns, hunting from an early age in a rural state, and I understand the issues, and we must find a way to investigate and discuss the problems that we're having in this country, and that's what we hope to do, and to discuss possible solutions. This program is designed to review the problem of gun violence in America from a public health perspective and to consider what can be done about it, taking into account the requirements of the Second Amendment. Certainly, some important considerations are: what impact does the Second Amendment have on measures designed to reduce injuries and deaths from guns? Is the Second Amendment a complete bar to all measures to reduce gun violence, as some would say? Or does the Second Amendment, as defined by the court's interpretations, allow reasonable laws and regulations designed to reduce gun violence, even if they affect or limit gun ownership, possession, or use? What have the courts, including the Supreme Court, said about this? And what has been done here locally, in Pennsylvania and in Philadelphia, to combat gun violence? And what further can be done? These are some of the things we will examine and we hope to advance the discussion of in the time available this afternoon. And thank you for braving the traffic. I understand there's some things going on in the city and that have backed things up quite a bit, and so there will be people trickling in, and we appreciate your efforts to get here today. As the program schedule and the speaker's biographical sketches indicate, we have distinguished speakers, first on public health issues, then on the law, including the Second Amendment, then on what has been done locally, with a panel discussion following each set of speakers. To keep things moving along, we will take questions only in writing. We have handed out cards for your questions. If you need another or some more, let us know, and we will hand out some more. We will collect those at the before each of the panel discussions and give them to the moderator. We'll have people at the end, if you pass a question down to the end of your row, either aisle, we will collect them there. With that, I give you Rich Negrin, the Managing Director and Deputy Mayor of Philadelphia, and we appreciate your being here today. It turns out there is a big day in Philadelphia. They have budget hearings, and as I understand, it's not just budget hearings. It's a big deal. That's part of the reason, I understand, for the traffic perhaps downtown. But we have Mr. Negrin. There's a piece on his background outside, and he will be followed by Jim Silkenet, who's president of the American Bar Association and a partner in the New York law firm of Sullivan and Worcester. And they will give us some introductory remarks. Mr. Negrin.
On behalf of Mayor Nutter and the great city of Philadelphia, first of all, welcome to Philadelphia. What better place to have this conversation than right here in the cradle of liberty, where many of our rights, most of our rights, were obviously created. The circumstance that David was talking about is, this is, if there's a State of the Union in Philadelphia, today is that day, where the mayor gets to stand up and give his budget address around his priorities for the 2015 fiscal year budget. So you can imagine there are people with all kinds of interest around what's going to be in that budget and what's going on, and they all want to have their say. So we're getting a great deal of protest and different things going on around Philadelphia. It was actually much quieter than it was last year, which was a little spooky. I kind of expected, you build yourself up for these. And the mayor actually gave the speech this morning, just about an hour and a half ago, totally uninterrupted, which was the first time that's happened in a long time. So I was pretty worried about that. I know David's worried about that happening right now during this speech, right? At some point today, there could be some of that activity, and that's what the free speech and what Philadelphia and the city of brotherly love is all really about. I want to give Dave a round of applause. Let's congratulate him for what a great program. As we talked about the possibility of bringing this here, obviously to a great place like Philadelphia and the Constitution Center, I could not have imagined such an impressive agenda throughout the day. Some of the best, most talented scholars on this subject are going to be here in Philadelphia, and I'm incredibly, incredibly proud of that. I want to, besides welcoming you generally, I want to talk just briefly, just for 2 minutes, about two aspects of, because we have so many experts in the room, you guys know more on this issue than I do. I want to talk about two aspects of the gun violence issue that often doesn't get discussed. The first one is the cost of violence. And I want to describe what I mean by that. And maybe it's because today's budget day and I'm thinking about, a $4.5 billion city budget here in Philadelphia. One third of that budget is for public safety. Think about that. One third of $4.5 billion here in Philadelphia going to combat violence and public safety. Think about that. And it's not just about that shocking number for me. It's about the opportunity cost that we don't talk about a whole lot. That's the cost of violence that I'm talking about. We're gonna have another several police classes because we have to get our police numbers. Every day we're losing 25 to 30 police officers to retirement. 6,000 police officers for a city of this size is way too small. So we're constantly fighting to keep those numbers up in light of what's happening to our changing workforce. When we look at the investments that we're making on public safety, every dollar spent on public safety is a dollar that we can't spend on our children. Every dollar spent on trying to combat this issue is a dollar we can't spend on poverty, on opportunity, on workforce development. We don't talk about that a lot, right? That's the cost of violence. We've done some great things in Philadelphia, and I'm incredibly proud. A new law enforcement strategy, great programs like Focus Deterrence, Philly Rising, community, really a community neighborhood initiative improving quality of life, taking community policing to a whole new level, winning awards around innovation in terms of what we're doing in our neighborhoods. A 40% reduction in homicides since this administration took office. The lowest numbers around homicides and crime since 1968 here in Philadelphia. And that's all great news, and it's all positive. But here's some of the stats that I think are still there that we still have to talk about. In 2013, here in Philadelphia, guns were used in 3,000 robberies, 2,200 aggravated assaults. In 2013, here in Philadelphia, adult shooting victims, over 1,000, 1,050 here in Philadelphia. Folks who died as a result of that, 189. In Philadelphia, juvenile shooting victims last year alone, 78. 9 of them died. Guess what? We've got some of the best trauma centers in the entire country. There are 5 critical, highly rated trauma centers in Philadelphia that save lives every single day, better than most cities. Those numbers would be far worse if our doctors weren't experts in saving their lives and treating gunshot wounds. Here in Philadelphia, the US Army sends their doctors to learn how to deal with traumas and violence because of what we've experienced here in Philadelphia. So despite the progress that we've made, there's a lot of work that's left to do. But I want you to think about that cost today as we talk about these issues. It is easy sometimes in an environment as sort of pristine and as beautiful as the Constitution Center to forget the real cost of what we're talking about today. And that's why I want to close briefly with the second phase. The first one, obviously, is the cost of violence. The second one is really the faces of violence and the faces of our victims that it's easy to forget We've got mothers in charge here that I know you'll be hearing from Dorothy later. They feel this viscerally in their soul because they've experienced this personally. I want to talk to you about some of our stories in Philadelphia. Just a year and a half ago, a dispute that began on Facebook, something stupid amongst kids, resulted in an adult shooting a carload of children inside of a car, killing two of them, right? That's the gun violence that happens in Philadelphia. Just last year in Logan, a two-year-old girl, I want you to imagine this, at a block party, 200 people present. A dispute arises amongst people who are at the block party. So you know everybody has to know who they are, right in the Logan section. That two-year-old girl, toddler, caught in the crossfire, shot in the abdomen. Not one person came forward. 200 people present. We solve our problems with gun violence still too often despite our numbers. And that's a huge issue. And those are real stories. That little girl was in the hospital for nearly 2.5 months trying to save her life and her organ functions for the rest of her life. And she still has a long, long recovery. A two-year-old girl. You know, I was so outraged, and the mayor was as well. There was a big cover of the Daily News where we said, speak up. You know, that is just unfathomable to me that a child will be injured like that as a result with people that you know who did it and don't come forward, right? That's part of the conversation here as well. So let's make sure we remember that. I want to close by talking about a 13-year-old boy whose father was murdered by a MAC-10 submachine gun. You know, our officers are outgunned in Philadelphia, right? Since the assault weapons ban has gone away. A MAC-10 that you could buy at a gun show that really has no legitimate sporting purpose. You guys know what gun that is, really short submachine gun with a long clip, easily adapted to be made, you know, a machine gun, not just a couple rounds. And someone drove past in a drive-by and shot that 13-year-old's father on a Sunday morning. It was the first time that father was going to see his son play football, Pop Warner. And they never got there because he was shot dead. And that 13-year-old held him in his arms as his father died right there in the street. I was that 13-year-old. That was me many years ago. This issue is real for me. It's personal for me. Guns like that have no place in our society. Think about those issues. Think about those victims. Think about the cost of violence. And let's have a great discussion. Thank you very much.
A very powerful start to the day. I want to welcome you all to this program at the National Constitution Center for a very important and constructive forum on gun violence issues in America. This is a perfect place, this building is a perfect place to hold this program. What does our Constitution require in terms of the Second Amendment, and what does it not? Lawyers have an important role to play in that discussion and in informing the public and informing our state and national legislators about how we can all be safer and still maintain our important Second Amendment rights. Most gun owners are responsible and law-abiding. They use their weapons for hunting, you know, like I did growing up in Kansas, for sport, for other lawful purposes, protected by the Second Amendment. But as we have learned from mass shootings in Columbine, Aurora, Sandy Hook, and a number of other locations, this is not always the case, and which is why we are gathered here today. We may not be able to prevent every shooting, but I believe we have an obligation to try to do more to stop gun violence in this country. Since the Kennedy administration, the American Bar Association has promoted policies to reduce gun violence and advance public safety through greater enforcement in existing gun laws and in adoption of reasonable gun regulations as allowed by the Second Amendment. The first ABA policy related to gun violence was adopted in 1965, supported amending federal law in a number of important respects to address interstate sales of firearms through formerly unregulated mail order purchases, including the rifle used by Lee Harvey Oswald to kill President Kennedy. These reforms were later enacted as key provisions of the Gun Control Act of 1968, the principal federal law regarding firearm sales, transfers, and possession, which those provisions are still operative today. As a national voice of the legal profession, the ABA has been and should be at the table for important conversations that involve our nation's laws. But the ABA should also be at the forefront of discussions about strategies to reduce gun violence across a wide range of disciplines, including many that are going to be represented and discussed here today. Our goal this afternoon is to examine the current state of the law and the undeniable violence we see in our cities. We are proud to include local voices that are less often heard, including voices from the local faith community here in Philadelphia. We hope today's discussion will begin a conversation on ways that we can all come together to reduce gun violence endemic to our communities. Gun violence is a difficult and oftentimes emotionally charged topic, but I hope that we can use this common place as a starting point for a fruitful discussion. Conversations on this issue, like the one we are having today, are very important for the sake of those we have lost through gun violence, for those left behind, and out of respect for the long tradition of responsible gun ownership in this country. Today's event is one of many discussions the ABA is convening around the country on this set of topics. We hope to engage all perspectives as we move forward towards common sense policies that work to prevent gun violence and protect our important Second Amendment rights. So thank you for joining us today. I look forward to engaging with all of you in the discussion. Thank you.
We'll now have our first group of speakers and panel on the public health side, and I'm not going to say a lot about these or the other speakers. We have biographical sketches out there. If we spent time going over that, we would be here for a lot longer. They tell us we have to get out of here at 5 o'clock. The next group is on public health perspective. Jan Vernick is from the Johns Hopkins School of Public Health and from their Center for Gun Policy and Research, Susan Sorensen, University of Pennsylvania, here in Philadelphia, and Matt Miller from the Harvard Injury Control Research Center. And with that, I give you the group.
Well, thank you very much, David, and thanks to the ABA and to President Silkenit for its leadership on this issue. We're very grateful and thrilled to be here. So it's my job, once my first slide appears. There we go. Do we go? All right, to provide a brief overview of guns and public health. So as David said, I teach at Johns Hopkins and co-direct the Center for Gun Policy and Research. So what do we mean by a public health perspective on gun violence? Well, one thing we mean is to consider all different kinds of deaths from gunfire, homicide, suicide, accidents, and all of the different kind of victims. And Dr. Susan Sorensen will talk about victims of intimate partner violence, but we consider all different kinds of victims. We focus on prevention, trying to prevent these deaths from happening in the first place, rather than primarily on punishing the perpetrators. Not that that's unimportant, but the public health perspective tends to emphasize prevention. We consider the important role of the vector, that is the firearm. If this were malaria, we would consider the role of the mosquito or the virus, but here it's the firearm. We design, implement, and evaluate interventions, and we tend to take multiple approaches using many different disciplines. So one of the things that we ask ourselves is, what are the relative risks and benefits of guns? And it's important to acknowledge that guns do have benefits associated with them, not just the recreational benefits that David mentioned, but guns can be protective. They are used in self-defense. How often that happens The estimates vary a great deal from relatively small numbers to much higher numbers. And there's even more maybe controversy about whether some or even many of those defensive gun uses are in fact socially desirable, or are they undesirable? Some high-risk person or criminal defending himself or herself against another person. And we balance those things against the risks, that is the public health burden, and that's primarily what I'm going to be talking about. Another way of flavoring, if you like, that risk-benefit equation is this advertisement from Beretta some years ago saying that a gun will, in this case in the home environment, will tip the odds in your favor. If that's accurate, then probably there are some kinds of things that we wouldn't choose to do if, on the other hand, the data suggest otherwise, as some of our panelists will cover, then maybe there are important things consistent with the Second Amendment that we need to do to reduce the risks associated with guns in the United States. So those guns out there are associated every year. This is the pie chart of gun deaths with, in 2010, with 31,000 gun deaths in the United States, 31,000. And maybe it surprises at least some of you that the largest share of those deaths in yellow, more than 19,000, are actually suicides. There are still 11,000 homicides, but 19,000 suicides. And that's why Dr. Matt Miller from Harvard will be presenting on that precise part of the problem. So I'll say less about suicides as we go forward. If you, instead of looking just at a one-year snapshot, if you look over time, in this case from 1962 to 2010, you see that we're relatively fortunate, if you want to say that, in that gun deaths over the last few years at least haven't been going up. We've been relatively stable at about 30,000 deaths. It's obviously far too many, and we need to be thinking about ways to reduce that number. But if you look back only a few years, we had almost 40,000 such deaths, 25% more. In 1993. And so it's critically important, in addition to trying to reduce those 30,000 deaths, to make sure that we don't wind up back in the bad old days of 1993 when we had 40,000 deaths. So it's, again, critical to understand what works and what doesn't to prevent these kinds of deaths and to make sure we don't, God forbid, wind up worse than we are now. Similarly, again, if you look over time at the homicides, the recent peak, again, was in 1993, pushing 20,000 homicides, again, compared to the 11,000 that we have now, too many, but certainly we don't want to be back in a world where we have that many homicides, gun-related homicides, every year. Here are the unintentional deaths, or what you might more colloquially call the accidental deaths. And there, the chart looks very, very different. There, we've had massive success over time. Again, we're down to about 600 unintentional or accidental deaths every year, compared with well more than 2,000 if you go back some number of years. For my money, we haven't fully explained that decline. It's an impressive success story. There are a number of possible explanations, but I don't think we've really nailed it down. If you saw this kind of chart for a chronic disease, for an infectious disease, and we didn't know the reason, you can be sure that we would be flooding research centers with funding to try to answer that question. But one of the reasons, again, for my money, that we don't have a clear answer is that we haven't devoted the kind of research funding that's proportional to the nature of the problem. So as the saying goes, the deaths are the tip of the iceberg, and the non-fatal injuries are important as well. For every fatality in 2012, we had about 2.5 non-fatal firearm-related injuries, more than 80,000, and then more than 400,000 violent crimes that occur with a gun every year. So how many guns are there? Again, it's my job to give you the sort of big picture background. Our estimate, and I'm sad to say that it's an estimate because we don't, for the most part, register guns in the United States the way we register cars. You can't just count up, if you want to know how many guns there are in the US, you can't just count up the number of registrations. We have to engage in estimates. And in fact, this estimate of 300 million guns in civilian hands comes from a survey that comes out of the Harvard Injury Control Research Center and Matt Miller's group. Of that 300 million guns, again, maybe it surprises you that the majority of those are long guns, that is, hunting guns, rifles, and shotguns. Only about 40%, roughly speaking, are handguns, and that translates to about a third of U.S. households that have at least one gun in them. That number's been going down over the years, and that's something else that we could talk about. Now, despite the fact that handguns are 40% of the U.S. gun stock, if you look at the share of firearm-related homicides, so now we're talking about gun homicides, the share of gun homicides that are committed with a handgun is approaching 90%. So even though they're not the majority of all guns, they're the vast majority of the homicides with guns, and that figure has been very, very stable over time. When we talk about a gun homicide problem in the US, we're largely talking about a handgun problem. Now, for other kinds of gun deaths, like suicides and accidents, the picture might be a little bit different. But for homicides, we're largely talking about a handgun problem. We heard the importance of considering the cost of gun violence. Estimates here too vary some. A recent estimate is about $170 or so billion dollars. When you add up all of the different costs, not just the medical costs, but the kind of opportunity costs that that the former speaker was mentioning. And if you divide that by the number of guns out there, you get around $600 for every gun in the US, and the guns that are out there are not carrying that cost. That's, as an economist would say, that's an externality that's being pushed onto all of the rest of us. So the reason that, again, I'm so pleased that the ABA has taken such wonderful leadership on this is that law is such an important and effective tool for gun violence prevention, whether we're talking about legislation, which Julie Leftwich in the next panel will talk about, or litigation, which John Lowy in the next panel will talk about, or even regulation, although regulation at the federal level is tough to come by. So let me just give you a quick example from an area that I work on about how law can be an enormously powerful, but unfortunately underutilized, I would argue, tool. And that has to do with the regulation of gun dealers. And it's important to ask yourself, where are the guns that are being used in crime? Where are they coming from? And I think people don't fully appreciate that basically every gun that's ultimately winds up in private hands, even the private hands of someone who ultimately uses that gun in crime, was first sold by a licensed gun dealer, a federally licensed gun dealer. Really, the only exceptions are those guns that were stolen directly from a dealer or stolen directly from the manufacturer. That's the bad news. Further bad news is that really we have most gun dealers, most of the 50,000 gun dealers in the US are businessmen who want to follow the law and do follow the law. But we have a small number of gun dealers. The best research, which is not that new anymore, but suggests that about 1% of those 50,000 dealers, so around 500 dealers, sell more than half of the guns that are ultimately traced to crime and recovered by the police. So one thing you could do about that is to have better licensing and oversight of gun dealers. Make sure that we focus on those small number of problem gun dealers. I mentioned that gun dealers are federally licensed, but states could license gun dealers as well. So let me ask you all a question. How many U.S. states license the person who cuts your hair, the cosmetologist? Out of 50 U.S., I won't make you, this is not my classroom, I promise, I won't call on you. The answer is all of them. So 50 U.S. states license cosmetologists. How many U.S. states license the person who sells your gun to you? The answer is 18. And why is that important? I mentioned that gun dealers have to be licensed at the federal level. Well, if they're licensed at the state level, we can have a lever to pull at the state level if we engage in adequate oversight and inspection of those dealers to maybe take their license away if they're not doing the right thing. And criminals do get their guns from licensed dealers sometimes, even directly. This is data that was produced at my center with the help of Dr. Kate Vitties, who's here, and Daniel Webster, showing that 11% of people who are in prison and who used a gun in their most recent crime, 11% got the gun directly from a licensed dealer. This doesn't even count the people who got it indirectly from a dealer. So again, what can law ultimately do about this? So research that we've done suggests that if a state does have strong dealer regulation, that is, if it does license gun dealers and engage in some of these other things that you see here, record-keeping rules, inspections, in fact, does regular inspections of those gun dealers, that you can have much lower levels of a measure of gun trafficking. That, not surprisingly, if you send the message to these dealers that we're looking out to make sure you're following the law, more of them will ultimately follow the law. So again, that's just one example of many more that will come today of how law can be an enormously potent tool, and again, why it's quite appropriate, I would argue, for the ABA to be part of this. But of course, as you'll hear from Dean Chemerinsky later on, laws have to be constitutional. It's appropriate in our democracy, of course, for laws to comport with the Constitution, but it also just makes good strategic sense. You certainly do not want to be spending a lot of your political capital advocating for a law that ultimately the courts have to strike down. So no one wants that, the gun violence prevention groups least of all. So let me conclude by saying that I hope I've persuaded you, if you weren't already, that guns do pose an unacceptable public health burden, but that we can do something about it. Sometimes there's a sense of hopelessness about this issue, and I hope today's group, although it will talk about the obstacles, will give you a sense of hope that we have had successes and we can have more in the future, especially if we bring multiple disciplines together. Public health, law, medicine, law enforcement is enormously important, public policy, psychology, sociology, and as long as we're careful to avoid violating protected rights. And I'll finish by saying that a year ago, we brought together a group of scholars to produce the book that is on the left there, and just today, actually, hot off the presses, we have an update to that book, chapter writers producing information about what's happened over the past year, and both of these for free are obtainable on the Center for Gun Policy and Research's website. So thank you very much.
Good afternoon, and being based here in Philadelphia, I'm going to borrow from Mayor Nutter and welcome you to the city of brotherly love and sisterly affection. We're glad to have you here. And that's what I'm going to be talking about today. Love and affection gone horribly wrong. Because when we think of guns, we think of in the street, we think poverty, we think men. And less often do we think about guns in the home and how they're used in the home. And this topic is a bit different as well, because it's not just some amorphous individual or stranger, but it's a specific known person who is a risk to another specific known person. In my short time today, I'm going to figure out the slides. In my short time today, I am going to talk to you about a few key points. One is that there are several solid specific policies that are in place. The implementation and enforcement of these policies is uneven, and the evaluation of these policies is difficult, but it's promising. Also, to tell you why these things are important for women's health and safety, and to close with a few suggestions that might provide some room for improvement. Okay. You all may have heard of prohibited purchasers and possessors, the 1968 Gun Control Act, specified that convicted felons, people who had renounced their citizenship, people who were dishonorably discharged from the military, were not allowed to purchase or possess a firearm. Okay. In 1994, with the Violence Against Women Act, they added persons who were under certain domestic violence restraining orders. Okay. Those restraining orders by federal law were those in which the person who was to be restrained, to be kept back from, to protect the other person, it was somebody who had had the chance to appear at a hearing and defend him or herself. Okay. So a judge had said, this person is a specific risk to this person, and we're not going to let that person have a gun, which makes sense. Okay. In 1996, we then added what was called the Lautenberg Amendment, and it added misdemeanors. Felons were already prohibited purchasers and possessors. They added misdemeanors of domestic violence because it's really hard to get an aggravated assault, a felony charge, in a case in which there are intimate partners. Even the injuries are the same as if it's strangers. It's really hard to get an ag assault charge conviction. Okay. As of 2008, 13 states had laws that went beyond the federal law. Usually by expanding the class of victims to include dating persons and such. Also in 2008, President George W. Bush signed into law the NICS Act. It provides resources to states, not an unfunded federal mandate, but a funded federal mandate, to improve the amount and quality of information about domestic violence that is submitted for use in the National Instant Check System. So that helped. And in some ways, purchase is easy, okay, because it has to do with people going, getting a gun and acquiring one. Possession, which involves either the person relinquishing a gun or a gun being seized and its removal, is more of a challenge. And there's law enforcement resistance to this for a variety of reasons. Okay. As of 2004, work that was done by Jan Vernick, our first speaker, 18 U.S. states had laws authorizing police to remove guns when responding to a domestic violence incident, so at the scene. Okay. 16 U.S. states had a law allowing courts to order the guns removed when a restraining order was issued. 17 states had both laws, and 26 states had neither law. Okay. I'll encourage you to look at the Law Center to Prevent Gun Violence's website. In 2008, they reported similar numbers, and they just updated their website with this information, or this information on their website, I should say, just a few weeks ago. Okay. The laws themselves are not uniform. Okay. In Pennsylvania, for example, in 2005, the law that was enacted here authorizes, but it does not require, the removal of guns at the scenes. And if so, it's limited to the gun that was used in that incident. A person could have an entire arsenal on the wall, but it's only the gun that was used to threaten or used against the person that could be removed. Okay. And then also as of 2008, about 18 states had laws about removing the guns or ammunition at the scene. And some research that we did found that public support for this is really high. In fact, there's much greater support for removing guns at the scene of a domestic violence than there is for arresting the perpetrator in a scene of domestic violence. So, as I mentioned, implementation and evaluation. There are challenges to the evaluation, largely because there's uneven implementation and enforcement. The laws vary from jurisdiction to jurisdiction. And also because, luckily, there's a low base rate of intimate partner homicide. Okay. The few evaluations that have been done to date, and there have been just a few, ones by Vigdor and Mercy, Dugan et al., and Zioli and Webster, they have found modest effects, okay, which is a good positive step with things that are this uneven in implementation and enforcement. Okay. So some of these policies may have promise. I'll talk more about that towards the end. But why are these things even important? And why are they important for women's health and safety? Well, as we can see, good news, like other forms of homicide, intimate partner homicide in the United States is down. It's down substantially in the past 30 years. The risk of homicide is highest in intimate partner homicide when the woman is trying to end the relationship, when she's doing exactly what we tell her to do, which is to leave. So what we do see, and we separate it out by gender, is that intimate partner homicide has dropped radically for men and somewhat less so for women. And men's intimate partner homicide by guns have dropped by over 80%. Their non-gun homicides have dropped by about half. And for women, their intimate partner homicides by guns have dropped by about 40%. So let's take a look at those numbers. I pulled the data from the FBI for the most recent years available. And from 2006 to 2011, as you can see, I'll just walk you through this chart. The bars on the left for each year, because we have 2006, 7, 8, 9, 10, and 11 at the bottom. The bars on the left side under each year are by an intimate and what weapon that person used. On the right are strangers by all lethal means. So we can see on the left side, that red bar is the handguns that have been used. The darker blue bar is long guns, and then the lighter blue bar is the ones that are a gun, but it was unspecified what type. And so we've confirmed here something that was noted first about 20, 25 years ago, that women are about 2.5 times as likely to be shot and killed by their husbands or another male intimate as they are to be shot, stabbed, strangled, bludgeoned to death, or killed in any other way by a stranger. And among abused women themselves, because this is just the general population, but if we look at abused women and who have a chronic history of being abused, okay, even after taking into account a range of victim, suspect, abuse, and incident characteristics, abused women are over 5 times more likely to be killed by their abuser if the abuser has access to a gun. Okay. So we've been looking at and talking about fatalities. Now let's look at what we in public health call non-fatals. And we'll see that firearms are used to coerce as well as to kill. From a survey that was done in the late 1990s, we found that about 3.5% of the women in the United States had had a partner threaten them with a gun, and slightly under 1% had a gun used against them by an intimate partner. Okay. This is the entire population of the United States. Okay. And as public health folk, you know, you might look at these percentages and shrug, but the numbers themselves suggest otherwise. So calculating these out for our 2012 estimates, it's our most latest population estimates to do, that means about 4.3 million women, adult women alive in the United States today, had been threatened with a gun by their intimate partner. Okay. And about 850 of the adult women had either been shot or shot at by their husband or someone who they at least at one time loved. That's roughly every adult woman in Boston, Denver, New Orleans, who's celebrating Mardi Gras these days, and in Sacramento. Okay. So again, these are estimates from a representative sample of community residing adults. Okay. Battering, an ongoing, multifaceted type of violence is different, and coercive control is at its core. So I'm going to tell you a little bit about a survey that we did of 417 residents of 67 battered women's shelters. And we find on the left side of these bars is the general population. On the right side are those who were the residents of the shelters. And we can see that guns, both long guns, any gun at all, and handguns are far more common in the homes of women where there has been battering. Okay. So it's almost three times more common, so a weapon is used. And in about two-thirds of the homes with one or more handguns, the partner used the gun against the woman. Over 70% had threatened to shoot or kill the woman, and 5% had actually shot or shot at her. What we also found interesting is that if a firearm had been used against her, there had been many, many different types of weapons used against her, over 8, compared to about 4 for those who had not had a gun used against them. Which to me, I take that if you beat a woman, if you want to coerce a woman, you don't have to do that if you have a gun. You don't have to beat her. You don't have to use other weapons. The gun and its presence and the threat of its use can get her to do what it is an abuser wants her to do. So just to reiterate the key points that I had, there are several very solid specific policies in place. Implementation and enforcement is uneven, but the challenging evaluations that need to be done have shown promising results. Guns are important to women's safety and health. And there's room for improvement. And with that, I'm going to offer a few closing thoughts. One is we might be able to say a bit more in a few years because with Obama's executive actions of last January, he ordered the Centers for Disease Control to begin conducting research on gun violence. They had basically stopped doing that for a long time. The Institute of Medicine, at the request of the Centers for Disease Control, developed a national research agenda and research priorities. In record time. Since then, the National Institutes of Health, National Institute of Justice, have issued calls for proposal to fund more research in this area. The Centers for Disease Control have yet to act. But perhaps we will have more to say. Also, I think what's important is I've talked about these specific laws that are specific to intimate partner violence, but there are other laws that are important too. For example, when people say stand your ground laws, what do they think? They think Trayvon Martin in Florida, right? George Zimmerman. Okay. There's another Florida case that's not Trayvon Martin, but Marissa Alexander. In 2010, her husband was after her. He refused to leave. He was threatening her and such. She fired a warning shot into the corner of the room by the ceiling. She was arrested, and in 2012, she was convicted and sentenced to 20 years. Okay, and that was for threatening, seeing that shot as a threat to her husband and her 2 children. A September 2013 appeals court threw that out because the jury had been told she had to prove beyond a reasonable doubt that he had abused her. Okay, so it sort of shifted what the focus of the trial actually was. Well, on Monday of this week, the Florida State Attorney said that she will retry the case and seek the maximum sentences if convicted, these sentences be served consecutively, which would be 60 years, and essentially give this woman a life sentence. Okay. No one was killed. No one was hurt. So we have to talk about how these stand your ground laws are being implemented. Another thing we might want to look at is internet sales. Zena Houghton had a restraining order against her husband, but he got a gun online from an online dealer. And those sales are not required to have a background check. Okay. He shot and killed her and 3 others at a spa, and then wounded several others, and then killed himself in October 2013. Like many other people who have been touched by gun violence, her brother was moved to action, and Elvin Daniel presented a petition of 60,000 signatures to Congress. Okay. So these are just some of the other things that are now and current that we can also look at and consider in trying to make the world safer and marriages not as bad for some. Thank you.
Good afternoon. My name is Matt Miller from the Harvard Injury Control Research Center. It's an honor to stand here before you. 1 year ago, this past January, at the invitation of my friend, colleague, and co-panelist, Jan Vernick, I spoke at the Johns Hopkins University in an assembly convened in the wake of the Sandy Hook massacre, where Adam Lanza killed 20 little children and 8 adults, beginning with his mother and ending with himself. Today's conference is animated by the memory of those children and adults, as well as by the memory of many others who have died outside of Sandy Hook before and since by gunfire. It's worth making an observation about what was typical and what was atypical about that fateful day in December. That more children and adults died by gunfire in the United States that day than in any other high-income nation is typical. That an assault-type weapon was used to kill them is not. That children died in one place, all at the hands of a single person, is not typical. What is far more typical is that young men, especially young men of color, are being killed one by one in obscenely, disproportionately large numbers here in this country every day. But for our nation as a whole, as has been said, the number of people who die by gunfire every year at their own hands by suicide outnumbers the number of people who are killed by other people with guns by almost 2 to 1. There are almost twice as many people who are dying by gunfire at their own hands as are dying by gunfire at other people's hands. And if what we're thinking about here today is the toll of lethal firearm violence, we have to think about suicide as well. In this country, there are over 300 million guns in civilian hands. Over half of all suicides are firearm suicides, and a third of all homes contain firearms. So we can't really have a conversation about preventing suicide in the United States without having a conversation about household gun ownership. And when we talk about suicide and guns, and this is the take-home message, the risk is not only assumed by the gun owner, it's also imposed on every other household member. This is like cigarette smoking, except in this case, as opposed to secondhand smoke, the imposed risk is at least as great in relative terms as the assumed risk. And the data that I will run through this afternoon will give you some insight into possibly why that's the case. Okay, well, there you have a picture of the United States. Everyone recognizes that. And when I talk in grand rounds to psychiatric audiences, I first show them this slide and they recognize, yes, that's a slide of the United States, and there's variation indicated in the rate at which suicide is distributed. In fact, rates vary more than threefold, which is much, much more variation than you see for almost any other cause of death, any other leading cause of death. And when I ask them, why do you think rates vary like that? The first response that I usually get is, oh, I didn't know that, that's interesting. And then the next is, well, there must be more depression or other mental illness or substance abuse in those places where suicide rates are much higher than in other places. That turns out, in fact, not to be the case. Oh, I guess you can't read my mind when I want the slide to change. So, there we go. Okay, so this is a slide, one among several I could have shown you, that that depicts suicide rates increasing at the state level as you go from the left to the right of the graph. What you see below that is this tremor of a line that doesn't really change that much. It's basically a little bit of noise that goes right across all 50 states. What that represents is the amount of serious psychological distress that is reported by people who live in each of the 50 states. It doesn't vary. People who live in Montana are a lot more likely to die by suicide than people who live in my state, Massachusetts, but they're not more likely to have serious psychological stress. They're not more likely to have depression. They're not more likely to think about suicide, plan suicide, or even attempt suicide. So how can we have more variation in rates at which people are dying by suicide across these 50 states than we have for almost any other leading cause of death, when the rates at which people are suffering to the point that they make attempts is pretty uniform? How can that be? If I were showing you a slide of motor vehicle crashes, and I told you there are more motor vehicle crash deaths in Montana than in Massachusetts, you would probably say people just drive faster on the roads in Montana because we have a lot of cities in Massachusetts. And that would be true. The rate at which people are getting into crashes is not that different, but the rate at which they're dying in crashes is higher. The same is true when you think about intentional injury, whether you're talking about homicide or suicide. The rate at which people are dying in their attempts is higher in the United States when they live in states, as it turns out, not surprisingly, given the talk, in states where gun ownership is more prevalent. Okay, so what you see here is the distribution of methods used in fatal versus non-fatal suicidal behavior. As you can see, slightly more than half of all suicide deaths are by firearms. When you look at non-fatal attempts, the vast majority, 4 out of 5, are poisonings, and another 15% or so are cuttings. The likelihood of death with poisoning or cutting is less than 5%. The likelihood of death if you shoot yourself is over 90%. This little picture up in the right-hand corner is one from a movie by Ames called The Powers of 10, and it's meant to remind me to tell you that there are 10 times as many non-fatal self-harm as there are suicides. 1 out of 10 acts proves fatal because most acts are with pills or cutting, but 9 out of 10 acts with firearms prove fatal, and that's an important concept to bear in mind. Okay, so here we have 7 states that gave us data to look at the distribution of suicide by method in relation to household gun ownership. I show you this slide, I'll show you one of 50 states as a plot, because it really makes the point pretty clear. What you see here is that Vermont and Maine and New Hampshire have much higher gun ownership rates than do New Jersey, Massachusetts, and Rhode Island. The rate at which people are dying, look in the last column, by non-firearm suicide is about the same, whether you live in the high gun or the low gun states. But when you live in a high gun state, rates at which people are dying by firearm suicide is a lot higher. And that's what drives the overall rate of suicide. That's why you can have similar rates of attempts across the 50 states and huge variation in the rate at which people are dying by suicide. Here's a plot, a scatter plot, and it's sort of infelicitous that the color I've chosen in the left lower corner is green in case you're colorblind. But when I show these slides, the axes are sometimes hard to read. And there's one of these that doesn't go with the other, as the Sesame Street ditty goes. There's one of these that really doesn't fit. And I think you can all see that it's this one here in the lower corner, the green one. The other two show a clear pattern of increasing rates of whatever the y-axis is as you move across the x-axis. Let's see, is this gonna, okay, there we go. So here, no pattern. This is the relationship between gun prevalence in a state and the rate at which people are dying by non-firearm suicide, just what we saw on the other slide. This slide is the relationship between gun prevalence, household gun prevalence, and the rate at which people are dying by firearm suicide. Very tight correlation. The net effect is a tight correlation between gun ownership and rates at which people are dying by suicide across the 50 states. Okay, this is a somewhat self-aggrandizing slide because it's work that I did with a student of mine that basically runs regressions and tries to account for differences in rates at which people attempt suicide. What you can see here, probably the clearest example here, this is the relationship between the rate at which people are dying by suicide with guns and suicide attempt rates. As you could have seen, you can imagine from what I've said previously, there is no correlation between rates at which people are attempting suicide and rates at which they're dying, because people are attempting at the same rates basically everywhere. And what determines, what drives, what causes higher rates of suicide in high gun areas or in households with guns is the presence of guns. Okay. This slide is a simple depiction of the toll of suicide in this country in the high gun versus the low gun state. So you've seen regression analyses and correlation coefficients and scatter plots and rates, but this is the number of people who are dying in high gun compared to low gun states to illustrate the real toll that we're talking about. Okay, so the high gun states have the same population as the low gun states. We took the states with the lowest gun ownership and we added them up, and the states with the highest gun ownership and added the population up, and just got an aggregate that balanced the total population. So all you have to look at are the numbers of people who are dying. So let's look at all adults. In the high gun states, there were over 7,000 firearm suicides, and there were 4,000 non-firearm suicides. In the low gun states, there were 1,600 firearm suicides and about the same number of non-firearm suicides. The net result, more than 5,000 more people are dying in the high gun states compared to the low gun states over this, 2-year period. It's a lot of people. Okay. So what do we know about these guns? We know that guns are much more likely to result in death when used in an attempt than any other commonly used method. We know that most of these come from people's homes. These are not guns that are, by and large, illegally trafficked. They're guns that have been in the homes for a long time, and they're not guns that are bought with the intent of killing oneself. We know that because not only the gun owner, but everyone else in the household is put at risk. And we've talked about the 300 million guns in civilian hands, okay. So why would making it harder for people to gain access to a gun reduce the likelihood that they're going to die by suicide? Wouldn't somebody serious enough about killing themselves to use a gun find another equally lethal way to die by suicide? Well, you wouldn't have the variation in rates of suicide that I've shown you, and you wouldn't have differences in suicide rates in gun owning compared to non-ongoing homes in the same neighborhood if that were the case. It's not an unreasonable hypothesis. If someone's serious enough, if I truly have intent that's serious enough to kill myself with a gun, wouldn't that intent persist long enough and for me to find another equally lethal way? The answer, the empirical answer to that reasonable speculation is no. We wouldn't have the patterns that we do if that were the case. And so what's the rationale? There are three well-established clinical observations and then one additional observation that helps undergird the idea that making it harder for someone to reach for a gun in a moment of impulse, of suicidal impulse, can save a life not only in the short run, but in the long run. And those are that many suicidal acts, especially among younger people, are impulsive. Two, suicidal crises are often ephemeral. Three, people who survive even nearly lethal suicide attempts have a very good prognosis with respect to whether they're going to die by suicide or not. I'm a physician, I trained as an oncologist, and the type of patient that I most hoped for in a clinic was a young man like Lance Armstrong who had testicular cancer, because the likelihood that that could be cured, even in its widely metastatic state, was better than 90%. Well, that's the prognosis that people have when they've attempted suicide seriously. They have as good a prognosis of not dying by suicide as Lance Armstrong had to survive his cancer. And this method-specific case fatality rate means what we said before. Guns are a lot more lethal than other culturally acceptable, commonly used methods here in the United States. There are lots of what are called case control studies, individual-level data that corroborate both in direction and magnitude the kind of information that I've shown you at the level of states and cities. And these studies have controlled for lots of different factors, and you basically get, this is a meta-analysis, a strong relationship between living in a home with a gun and the likelihood you're going to die by suicide, because you're more likely to die by firearm suicide without any difference in the rate which you're likely to, the likelihood at the risk of non-firearm suicide. All right, so here's one of the many studies that was done. This is by Art Kellerman back in 92, and what you can see is it, whether you have a handgun or a long gun, you're at increased risk for suicide if you live in a home with a gun. The way you store a gun matters. If it's loaded, it's worse than if it's not loaded. If it's locked, it's better than if it's not locked. There's this hierarchy of risk that's consistent with the exposure to guns, the likelihood of being exposed to guns. And that's particularly true when you're thinking about kids. This is a study of 5 to 19-year-olds who lived in homes with guns. And the question was, does the way you store it make a difference? The answer is it does. If you store it more safely, the kid is less at risk. But even a safely stored gun puts kids at higher risk than not having the gun at home, and it does by a considerable amount. The question has come up often, and it's relevant to the sort of litigation in trials about firearm ownership and the relationship between guns and suicide. Maybe gun owners are different from non-gun owners in ways that put them at higher risk for suicide. Again, a reasonable proposition, but not one that stands up to empirical scrutiny. Gun owners are no more likely than non-gun owners to have depression, anxiety disorder, you name it. That doesn't distinguish them. Sure, they're different. They bought guns. But they're not different in any way that we know is related to the risk of suicide. Okay. The time series analysis that I have up there simply says that if you look what happened in the mid to late 1990s in the United States, what we know is suicide rates dropped. And they dropped because firearm suicide rates dropped in tandem with declines in firearm ownership over that time period. Non-firearm suicide rates did not change. The net effect was a decrease in suicide rates, especially among younger people, of almost 30% over that time period. And studies that we've done using panel data have corroborated that, or at least have demonstrated that, controlling for various other factors. The other thing to note is over that time period, rates at which people were reporting depression or suicidal ideation or making suicide attempts also didn't change. So you see over time the same sort of pattern that I mentioned across space at the beginning of the talk. Here's a slide from The New Yorker back this past December. And when I saw this, you know, it made me think, yes, this looks like a homicide, okay, but the data are just so much better when it comes to suicide. I wish we could save some and apply it, because it's actually a lot harder to do the research on homicide to studies involving homicide. The data are overwhelming, they're incontrovertible, but we're forgetting about the toll. The gentleman who spoke earlier so movingly about his father dying in his own arms, it's a very powerful statement. And there are spokespeople for those who die in homicide, although mostly disenfranchised. There aren't the same stories for people who die by suicide, and yet the toll is enormous. All right. What are we doing? Are we acting on what we already know? Well, the short answer to that is no. This is a study of psychiatrists, and they were asked, do you talk to your patients who are suicidal about the risk of having a gun in the home? And as you can see, only 1 out of 5 talk to their suicidal patients about having a gun in the home. This is a study that we did in emergency departments, where we asked attendings and nurses and residents, did they speak to people who came in with suicidal behavior about whether they had a gun in the home? Well, if they had a gun, if they said they had a plan with a gun, then two out of three spoke with them. I don't know why the other one out of three didn't. But if they had a plan with something else, and they were suicidal, but it didn't involve a gun, only one out of five talked about having a gun. And that's the strongest risk factor that you can do anything about. All right. We asked in the same survey people, what did they think would happen? There are more than 1,000 people who die by gun suicide every month. What would happen if it was impossible for that person to get a hold of a gun during a suicidal impulse? And these are physicians and nurses and residents. Oops. And as you can see, two out of three nurses, two out of five physicians said that most or all of the people who died by firearm suicide would have found another equally lethal way, most or all. About 20%, about 30% of the general population thinks that not a single life could be saved. So that's the mindset that we are up against in thinking about the role of firearms and suicide. Okay, two more slides. Suicide can be prevented without necessarily doing anything about underlying mental illness. Means restriction is, in fact, the strongest, the approach that has the greatest potential to immediately and largely reduce rates at which people are dying by suicide in this country. There's no generic antagonism between trying to attend to people's suffering and making it more likely they're going to live through that suffering by putting distance between them and their gun. And we're not doing it nearly enough. Okay, this final slide is a picture of Ulysses bound to his ship's mast. It epitomizes the forward-looking action that anticipates sort of actuarial risk and takes steps to avoid calamity. This metaphor works as an illustration of the kind of enlightened self-interest that health professionals should strive to have their patients consider and indeed act upon. The metaphor may work as well, more broadly, as an illustration of societal actions that integrate science into public health policy. Preventing suicidal behavior and the suffering that leads to suicidal acts has been extremely difficult. But we can save lives still, both in the short run and in the long run, by enabling the kind of enlightened self-interest that Ulysses' choice exemplifies. After all, Ulysses survived where others perished, not because he was less compelled by the siren's calls towards death, but because he recognized his potential incapacity to resist those calls and took steps to avoid disaster. Thank you very much.
The domestic violence situations, do we have any solutions? Do we have any answers? What can we do, just quickly? Are there things, actions we can take, proposals we can adopt?
Yeah, I think one of the things that can be done, Sasan, can you hear me okay?
We need to be closer.
No, can't hear.
You need to be closer to it.
Better?
Yeah.
Okay. One of the things that can be done doesn't involve changing any laws, but it's simply implementing them. It can be done in an administrative level. They say, okay, we are now going to report all of our restraining orders and our domestic violence misdemeanor convictions to the National Instant Check System. There are a number of states that still don't do that, don't have the capacity to do that, haven't done that. It's similar with mental health records. And it does not require any new law on any level, but simply an agency saying, okay, we're going to do it. Pennsylvania did that and quickly went from very, very few to over 250,000 mental health records in the National Instant Check System within the space of a few days last year. We can do the same thing with restraining orders and domestic violence, just misdemeanor convictions, and that would be a good start that does not involve legislation and dealing with elected officials and their hesitance in terms of addressing some of those issues. So that's one thing.
Matt, any other solution? You did get in a group of them at the end there. Any idea on solutions on suicide? I mean, for example, you mentioned the gun storage. Do the safe storage laws make a difference? Are there studies?
There are studies, and there's a suggestion that they may. But most of the we're not gonna legislate our way towards huge reductions in suicide through direct legislation. But legislation or societal action more broadly can have an educative role if it helps shift the way people think about what responsible behavior is. Storing guns safely, for example. If legislation supports that sort of social shift, then I think you're going to see that there'll be a much greater chance that people are going to people's lives will be saved. I mean, you have other possibilities like smart gun technology. If only the dad's hand can pull the trigger or release the bullet, you've protected the other people in the home. So getting physicians and other healthcare workers and people like you in the audience to recognize that suicide is preventable, that the evidence is extremely powerful, and that it's not inevitable that somebody who's made an attempt is going to die. Just getting those ideas out there and having discussions about helping people make enlightened decisions in their own enlightened self-interest will probably be the surest way to reduce the toll.
Can I jump in on safe storage also for a second? So in the late 1980s, Florida, not known as your most rabidly anti-gun state, became the first state in the country to adopt what's called a child access prevention law. That's a law that says that if you do have a gun in your home, you have to store it safely so that young children can't gain easy access to it. Since Florida enacted its law, 17 more states have enacted these CAP, child access prevention laws, 18 states. And the research shows pretty substantial reductions in accidental shootings among children, and as Matt says, more modest reductions among in teen suicide. So clearly we're not going to safe store our way out of the teen suicide problem, but safe storage can have an important effect on both child accidents and maybe even a modest effect on teen suicides.
Oh yeah, definitely. Safe storage certainly can, and the extent to which the law actually affects that is really hard to pin down. When we did a study where we asked people, did they think they lived in a state which had the kind of laws that Jan mentioned, and almost everybody thought they lived in a state that had those sort of laws. And there was no correlation with thinking that you lived in a state like that and actually on the individual level how you stored your gun. But again, there may be something about the way these laws are promoted and the way it induces certain type of societal norms that could shift so behavior, and that's part of the role of legislation, I would imagine.
Let me ask one more here that a couple of people have written from the audience. Jan Vernick or anybody else can pitch in. Has anything been done to address or even shut down the 1% of firearm dealers that are leading to over 50% of the crime gun sales?
Great question. Yeah, actually some cities have done wonderfully innovative things. They've used their crime gun tracing data, the data associated with the guns that are recovered from police, then they get traced and you figure out which dealers are selling them. They've figured out which are their problem dealers, and a handful of cities have done very innovative things. They've done undercover sting operations of those dealers to catch them illegally selling their guns. Once they've caught them doing that, they've brought lawsuits, and maybe John Lowy will talk about this also, lawsuits against those dealers. And research that that we've done has shown that the cities who do that well, Chicago, Detroit, New York City, that target those problem dealers, sting them and sue them, big changes in illegal gun trafficking and changes in the number of their crime guns that are coming from those precise dealers. So yes, there absolutely are enforcement strategies that can work.
Jan, you had mentioned not spending the resources. You mentioned a decline in certain types of gun accidents or deaths, and indicating if this were a disease, we would be studying it a lot more. We haven't been putting the resources. Someone specifically asked, do you know why the Center for Disease Control has not done more, or why it stopped studying gun violence?
Well, so it's a story that takes place beginning around the mid-1990s. The CDC had been studying not just the not just the number of gun deaths, but risk factors for gun deaths, and had been looking at gun policy. And very explicitly, the National Rifle Association felt that that research was inappropriate. They lobbied their friends in Congress, and Congress took money away from CDC's budget and redirected it, the precise amount they had been spending on guns, they redirected towards towards other things, and they introduced a rider in CDC's annual appropriations that says that CDC can't use money to lobby for gun control. Now, they couldn't lobby for gun control even before that, but the action of calling this attention to it, forcing CDC officials to come to Congress and testify, ultimately wound up as a chilling factor. Now, as Susan mentioned, we have good reason to hope that that's changing. President Obama, in an executive action in 2013, instructed federal agencies that do that fund research to begin funding research on gun violence prevention. Again, CDC commissioned the Institute of Medicine to recommend to it what the major areas of gun violence prevention funding ought to be, and we're hopeful that that money will become available soon.
I first got involved in the issue of gun violence on July 1st, 1993. On that day, I was working at a law firm in the 101 California Street building in San Francisco. My former office was on the 23rd floor, and it was a day like any other. Then at about 3 o'clock, an announcement came over the loudspeaker saying, there's an emergency in the building, everybody lock your doors. I didn't know there was a loudspeaker, I'd never heard any announcements. We also didn't have any locks on our doors, so it was kind of a shocking thing to hear. We didn't hear anything else from the building that day about what was happening, but my firm had a moot courtroom, which had a TV in it, so those of us at the firm gathered in the moot courtroom and turned on the TV, and we learned that there was a gunman who was loose in the building. Subsequently, I learned that a former disgruntled client of the law firm of Pettit & Martin, which was located on the 35th floor, had come into the building with a couple of assault weapons and a handgun and began shooting. And when he was done, he had shot 14 people, 8 fatally. I was lucky that day. I didn't know anybody who was shot. I didn't lose a loved one or a colleague, but the event really shook me up both personally and professionally. I learned within a few days that lawyers at Pettit & Martin had immediately moved to form a new organization to use the unique skills of lawyers to do something about our nation's epidemic of gun violence. I reached out to them and started volunteering, and then a few years later I was able to come on staff. So just to tell you a little bit about what the Law Center to Prevent Gun Violence does, we provide free legal and technical assistance to legislators who are either seeking to enact or to defend laws to reduce gun violence. We draft model laws, we testify at hearings, and through our network of pro bono attorneys around the country, we file amicus briefs in Second Amendment cases. We track all Second Amendment cases nationwide. We also secure pro bono defense counsel for cities that are being sued. We also track all state gun bills nationwide. So before the 101 California Street shooting, I really didn't know much about gun violence or about our nation's gun laws. I tend to have progressive views about things, so I thought, yeah, gun control, that seems to make sense, but I really had no idea about the toll that gun violence takes on our nation. The last panel did an excellent job of describing that, and essentially, you know, we all read in the papers about these horrific events that take place, the Newtown shooting, the Aurora, Colorado shooting, these things that are the Sandy Hook, but they aren't representative of what's happening in our country each and every day. And 80 people are dying each and every day in communities all around the country, like Philadelphia. I was also shocked to learn, once I got into this issue, how weak our nation's gun laws are. When I went to law school and learned about the law generally, I would say that most of the laws seemed to make sense. They were rational. But when it comes to our federal gun laws, they are completely irrational, and they don't make sense, and they are filled with loopholes. In fact, the U.S. has the weakest gun laws of all industrialized nations in the world, and we also have the highest rates of gun death. The biggest loophole in federal law, and the one that's been in the news, is the private sale loophole. So essentially, under federal law, federally licensed gun dealers, and Jan mentioned the concept of somebody having to have a federal license, they have to conduct background checks on prospective gun buyers. But you don't have to be a federally licensed gun dealer to sell a gun. In fact, about 40% of all gun sales are made by unlicensed sellers. So they are completely outside the system. There's no background check, there's no private sale, there's nothing. So in the requirement that dealers conduct background checks was imposed as part of the 1993 Brady Act. But prior to 1993, even though the 1968 Gun Control Act sets forth various categories of people who aren't allowed to buy guns, there was no enforcement mechanism whatsoever. So before 1993, a gun dealer would ask a person, they'd fill out a form, are you a convicted felon? You know, have you been dishonorably discharged from the military? These type of things. And if the person said no, that's like, okay, well, that's good enough for me. You know, here's your gun. So at least there's been improvement, but we still have this massive loophole. We also have no licensing of gun owners and no registration requirement for guns. Personally, I think that guns should be regulated the way that cars are regulated. If you're going to drive a car, you need to get a license to show that you know what the laws are and that you're capable of driving, and you need to register your car so that if something happens to it, the authorities know who the vehicle belongs to. Well, we don't have anything like that at the federal level, even though actually most people think that we do, but we don't. In fact, under federal law, federal gun purchaser records are destroyed within 24 hours, and there's a provision in federal law that prevents the creation of a federal registry. So not only do we not have it, but federal law specifically says that we cannot have it. We also don't ban assault weapons or large-capacity ammunition magazines, and those are the type of magazines that are used in all of the mass shootings that we hear about. In 1994, one of the first things that my organization did was to work for the passage of the federal assault weapons ban. So that bill did pass in 1994, but it had a sunset provision, and it expired in 2004. So we did have a ban on those things at one point, but no longer. We also have no waiting period. As part of the Brady Act, initially there was a 5-day waiting period. In California, we have a 10-day waiting period, and that allows law enforcement time to conduct a thorough background check, and it also gives people time to cool off so that if they are thinking about suicide or some sort of other rash behavior, that there's some time for them to stop. But under federal law, the 5-day waiting period expired, so we have what's an instant check now. Also, if a background check is not completed within 3 days, the dealer can go ahead and transfer the gun even if he or she has not heard from the Bureau of Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms whether the person is prohibited or not. So these so-called default transfers happen, and thousands of guns are put on our streets, and law enforcement, if they later find that the person was prohibited, they then have to go out and try to retrieve those guns. One of the things that I found particularly shocking when I learned about this area was that guns are exempt from the Consumer Product Safety Act. So that's the federal agency that is supposed to ensure that the products that we all use are safe. But guns are the only product now that aren't governed by that act or governed by any other regulatory agency. So you have the bizarre situation now where a toy gun, if it's found to be defective and hurting a child, that can be recalled by the federal government, but a real gun cannot. Also, we have a federal immunity law, which bestows upon the gun industry, manufacturers, and sellers almost complete immunity for their negligence. And I know John Lowy will get into that a little bit later. And no other industry receives such preferential treatment under federal law. So under our federal system, states are free to adopt stronger laws than we have at the federal level, but historically most have not. In fact, what we've seen over the last 30 years is a gradual weakening of state gun laws. Some of the laws that states have been adopting in the past few years have been pretty crazy. Some of them have gotten into the news. For example, there have been a lot of laws passed to allow guns in churches and in bars and in courthouses. A bill in Georgia just passed the House recently and is expected to pass the Senate there. Hopefully the governor will veto that bill, but that's an example of one of these Guns Anywhere bills. There's also a bill that was passed in Florida, which prohibits doctors from asking their patients about gun ownership and advising them about gun safety. That law was challenged and was struck down by a lower court as being in violation of the First Amendment, and it's on appeal now to the 11th Circuit. Another crazy law, or I call it crazy laws, these laws that purport to exempt states from federal gun laws. So Montana was the first state to adopt this kind of law, and it basically says if a gun is manufactured in Montana and it stays within our borders, the feds need to stay out. We don't have to follow any federal laws, including the laws on background checks or anything else. So that law was also challenged and was struck down by the Ninth Circuit. But despite the fact that these laws are being struck down, they in some states they're very politically attractive, and so they keep getting passed. Some of the laws, though, that have been passed over the last 30 years are more insidious and more dangerous than the laws I just mentioned. A big trend has been a weakening of our state's concealed carry laws. So in most states, you have to get a permit to carry a concealed weapon. It used to be that law enforcement had discretion in all states to decide whether or not it was appropriate for an individual to have a gun. But the NRA promoted the repeal of those laws, so now we've gone from having a majority of what are called may-issue states, where law enforcement is vested with discretion about the issuance of policies, to having shall-issue states, where unless a person is a convicted felon or otherwise prohibited, that person can get a gun and carry a gun in public. The lax concealed carry laws are particularly dangerous when combined with other laws, such as the stand your ground, or what we call shoot first laws, that have been adopted in most states. Susan mentioned those laws earlier. In Florida alone, we've repeatedly seen how dangerous these laws can be. You had the Trayvon Martin shooting, when George Zimmerman, who was a concealed weapons holder, Michael Dunn, who shot Jordan Davis in the gas station over a dispute about music in a car. He was lawfully carrying a concealed weapon. And then there was the case in the Florida movie theater where the man shot the person sitting in front of him who was texting while the previews were going on. He's asserting a stand your ground law because he alleges that the guy threw some popcorn at him. So these laws are really outrageous, but again, with the stand your ground or shoot first laws, it isn't so much the concept that people don't have a duty to retreat in public, which is kind of how they started. It's the fact that not only do they not have a duty to retreat, but they are then emboldened to act aggressively and to take the law into their own hands when concealed weapons permits are basically given out like candy. Another area where there has been a weakening of laws is around the concept of preemption. So there are federal schemes, states can adopt stronger laws than the federal government can, and typically local governments can adopt stronger laws than the state government can, unless that authority has been taken away by the state legislature. And it used to be that local gun laws were very common in this country. But again, the gun lobby started promoting laws to prohibit local governments from regulating guns. And so now there are only about a handful of states that can regulate guns at the local level. Fortunately, where I live in California, local governments have a lot of authority. And in fact, over the last 20 years, cities and counties have adopted over 300 strong gun laws, and many of those have trickled up to the state level, so they've served as the models for state legislation. So even though I've said all these negative things about the state of our nation's gun laws, when you look at the big picture, things are finally starting to change, and things are getting better. The Newtown tragedy last December really triggered a cultural shift in our nation. And people have, for me, I was kind of surprised, or I wasn't surprised, I just didn't know how people were going to react to Newtown. Because we have seen so many mass shootings in this country, and after each one, I would think, well, okay, now this is, Columbine, all these kids, this is finally going to do it. Or when people were shot at a movie theater, or actually when Gabby Giffords was shot, I thought, okay, well now Congress is going to do something because one of their own has been taken down. So when that didn't happen, even though it was just horrific when all these little innocent little kids were shot last year, I just didn't know what was going to happen. So, I was pleasantly surprised to see that it seemed to be the straw that broke the camel's back and that people finally said enough is enough. So we have seen that change. And public opinion polls show that Americans are sick of the bloodshed and they want something to happen. And when you look at the policies, just universal background checks, requiring background check for all gun sales, polling shows that 90% of all Americans support that. And think how many other types of policies can you think 90% of the public supports that we don't have? So we have 90% of the public supporting that, 80% of gun owners, and 70% of NRA members. So the NRA came out in opposition to the federal bill that was proposed last year. They oppose universal background checks, which just shows that they don't represent their members, and they certainly don't represent the American public in general. So we were disappointed, of course, to see the background check bill failed last year, even though it was not a particularly strong bill. Just showed that Congress would not do anything on this. So we were disappointed, given the overwhelming public support, but not terribly surprised. And we just hope that if Congress continues to ignore the will of the people, that those members who have done that will get kicked out of office. In the meantime, the good news is that more and more states are stepping up. They are not waiting for Congress to act in this area. So as I mentioned earlier, we track all gun bills. And over the past 5 years, typically the ratio of good bills to bad bills has been 2-1 in favor of bills to weaken existing state law. So last year, we saw that flipped. And so for the first time, there were twice as many good bills than bad bills. We received requests for assistance from 30 states last year wanting to adopt common sense gun laws, and 21 states passed gun laws. And 8 of those laws were very significant, involving background checks, mental health reporting, domestic violence issues, bans on assault weapons, bans on large capacity ammunition magazines. This year we're tracking over 1,300 state gun bills. And although the pace has slowed a bit, and now it seems that it's about even as far as the ratio of good bills to bad bills, there's a lot more momentum than there used to be, and people are a lot more organized at the state and local levels. So there's really been historic progress when you look at the shift in state gun laws over the last even 5 years. It's been historic progress. So the final point I want to make is that strong gun laws work. The Brady bill alone, even though it has a loophole, it has stopped over 2 million prohibited people from buying guns. So the law has worked. There's also a strong correlation between the strength of a state's gun laws and its rate of gun deaths. We did a joint publication with the Brady campaign where we rank all state gun laws, and we found that out of the 10 states with the strongest gun laws, 7 of those states also had the lowest rates of gun deaths. So there's a clear correlation between the strength of a state's gun laws and its rate of gun deaths. So California is a great example of how this can work. Since the 101 California Street shooting, California has adopted 30 strong laws to reduce gun violence. We've closed the most glaring loopholes in federal law and also adopted several other types of cutting-edge laws. And the laws have had a huge impact. In the last 20 years, our rate of gun deaths has dropped 56%, which is nearly twice as high as the rate of gun deaths has dropped nationwide. So, of course, what we really need are strong, uniform federal laws, because it's easy for guns to go from state to state. They typically flow from states with weak gun laws into states with strong gun laws. In fact, the shooter in the 101 California Street shooting bought his assault weapon in Nevada because assault weapons were already illegal in California. But until Congress acts and until we get those laws, it's crucial that the states continue to step up. So in closing, I just want to say that although I know it'll take time, I'm convinced that eventually we will get the type of laws that we need in this country to address the nightmare of gun violence. As Jan mentioned earlier, there is hope. So even though the statistics are very bleak, we don't have to live this way. We can change our nation's laws. And there are things that you who are here today can do if you're interested in helping that, making that happen. If you're new to this issue, stay involved. Make your voice heard. Contact your elected officials at the federal, state, and local level and let them know that this issue matters to you. And ask your friends and family to do the same thing. Speak out. Also, stay informed about pending legislation and speak out so that the NRA isn't the only one that our legislators hear from. Most people support stronger gun laws, but there's this passion gap. Those who are opposed to these laws are extremely passionate, and so they are motivated to speak out, to write letters, to make the phone calls. And so those of us who are on the other side, who are in the silent majority, need to do the same thing. I would also say support organizations that are dedicated to reducing gun violence, like Ceasefire Pennsylvania and the other groups that you're going to hear from today. Change won't happen overnight, but if we all work together, it will happen. Thank you very much.
Our first panel today dealt with public health perspectives and provided us with a wealth of facts, a wealth of information on exactly what the problems are. The second panel is dealing with the legislative perspectives, legal perspectives on all of these issues. And our next speaker is Dean Erwin Chemerinsky from the University of California, Irvine, really one of the outstanding scholars, constitutional scholars in the United States. Erwin.
Thank you so much for the kind introduction. It's really an honor and a pleasure to be here as part of this important and terrific conference. From 1791, when the Second Amendment was ratified, until 2008, the Supreme Court always had said that the Second Amendment is about a right to have firearms solely for the purpose of militia service. For example, in 1939, in United States versus Miller, the Supreme Court upheld a federal law prohibiting sawed-off shotguns. The Supreme Court said, just in passing, that of course what the Second Amendment was about was a right to have guns for purpose of militia service. It didn't have anything to do with the right to have guns for one's own personal safety. When I began teaching constitutional law 34 years ago in 1980, I spent very little time on the Second Amendment. There was no dispute as to the meaning of the Second Amendment. It was just what it said, a right to have guns for the purpose of militia service. After all, the Second Amendment says, a well-regulated militia being necessary to a free state, the right of the people to keep and bear arms shall not be infringed. There was, though, a very organized campaign involving gun rights activists and academics to convince courts to change the meaning of the Second Amendment. And that occurred in June of 2008 in District of Columbia versus Heller. What I was asked to talk about this afternoon is the meaning and myths concerning the Second Amendment in light of where the law is today. I want to address two questions. First, what has the Supreme Court said about the meaning of the Second Amendment? Second, what are the unresolved issues with regard to the meaning of that amendment? As to the former, there are really two relevant Supreme Court cases at this point in time. District of Columbia versus Heller, that I already alluded to, from 2008, and McDonald versus City of Chicago from 2010. I want to talk about each of them. District of Columbia versus Heller involved a 35-year-old DC ordinance that prohibited private ownership or possession of handguns and imposed significant restrictions on long guns. A challenge was brought by an individual, his private security guard, who wanted to continue to have and possess his firearm. The Supreme Court, 5-4, ruled in his favor and declared the DC ordinance unconstitutional. I don't know when in American history views about guns came to be so ideologically defined, with guns rights activists tending to be more conservative, gun control activists tending more liberal, but that's exactly how the Supreme Court divided on that June day. Justice Antonin Scalia wrote the opinion for the majority. It was joined by Chief Justice Roberts, Justice Kennedy, Justice Thomas, and Justice Alito. Justices Stevens and Breyer wrote dissenting opinions, joined by Justices Souter and Ginsburg. Justice Scalia began by saying that there's a prefatory part and an operative part to the Second Amendment. He said, the language that speaks of a well-regulated militia being necessary to a free state is just prefatory language. He said that the operative language of the Second Amendment is the right of the people to keep and bear arms shall not be infringed. Justice Scalia said, prefatory language cannot undermine the meaning of operative language. He did his textual analysis of the words, the right to keep and bear arms, as well as what militia meant in 1791, and concluded that it was a right of individuals to have firearms for the purpose of personal safety. He looked at contemporary understandings of the Second Amendment. He looked at writings about the Second Amendment. He looked at historical interpretations of the Second Amendment, and included that the Second Amendment protects the right of individuals to have firearms, at least in their homes, for the sake of security. But very importantly, and often overlooked, the Supreme Court emphasized that the Second Amendment is not an absolute right. Justice Scalia said, the government can regulate who has guns, such as keeping those with a felony conviction or a history of mental illness from having firearms. He said the government can regulate where guns are located, such as preventing guns in airports or in schools. He said the government can regulate the types of weapons people possess. There'd be no Second Amendment right to have an assault rifle, a bazooka, or other kinds of high-capacity, high-damage weapons. The court ended simply by emphasizing that what it had found was a right to have handguns in the home for the sake of personal security. As I mentioned, Justice Stevens wrote a lengthy dissent. He took Justice Scalia on with regard to the historical evidence. Justice Stevens, writing for the four dissenters, rejected the notion that there's a prefatory part and an operative part of the Second Amendment. He said all of the language in the Second Amendment is operative, and the Second Amendment is unique among constitutional rights in that it states its purpose. The Second Amendment says that the purpose is to make sure that there'll be a well-regulated militia. The Second Amendment was meant to keep Congress from regulating guns in a way that would keep states from protecting themselves. But it was not about a right to have personal ownership of guns. Justice Stevens, too, looked at the text of the Second Amendment, what the phrase keep and bear arms meant in 1791. He looked at what militia meant in 1791. And he stressed the importance of precedent. After all, from 1791 until June of 2008, without exception, the Supreme Court had said that the Second Amendment is just about a right to have guns for purpose of militia service. Justice Breyer wrote the other dissenting opinion. He said, that the government should be able to regulate guns so long as it is acting reasonably. Justice Breyer said, if we're going to look at historical practice, all of the states that have state constitutional provisions with regard to the right to have guns allow reasonable regulation. So should reasonable regulation be permitted when it comes to federal laws. Justice Breyer reviewed the epidemiological studies, the kind of evidence you've heard this afternoon, that gun regulations do decrease crime and do decrease gun violence. He said, based on this, the DC ordinance should be upheld as a reasonable regulation. The law that was involved in District of Columbia versus Heller was a federal law. The District of Columbia obviously is a part of the federal government. The Supreme Court had no occasion, therefore, to consider whether the Second Amendment would also apply to state and local governments. The day after the Supreme Court handed down its decision in District of Columbia versus Heller, the National Rifle Association filed lawsuits in federal court in Chicago and San Francisco, challenging those cities' gun ordinances. The National Rifle Association, in highly publicized press conferences, said it wanted to bring to the Supreme Court as soon as it could the issue of whether or not the Second Amendment limits state and local governments as well. After all, never in American history, from 1791 through 2008, had the Supreme Court ever found that the Second Amendment limits what state and local governments can do. But in the second case that I mentioned, McDonald versus City of Chicago, in June 2010, the Supreme Court held that the Second Amendment does apply to state and local governments. Here, Justice Alito wrote for a plurality of four. His opinion was joined by Chief Justice Roberts, Justice Scalia, and Justice Kennedy. Justice Thomas concurred in the judgment. Now, all five of these justices believe that the Second Amendment applies to state and local governments. They just have a different way of getting there. The four in the plurality would say that the Second Amendment applies to state and local governments through the Due Process Clause of the 14th Amendment. That's the way the other provisions of the Bill of Rights have been applied to state and local governments. Justice Thomas would use the so-called Privileges or Immunities Clause of the 14th Amendment, the provision that says no state can deny any citizen the privileges or immunities of United States citizenship. There were again four dissenting justices, Justices Stevens, Ginsburg, Breyer, and now Sotomayor, all argued that the Second Amendment should not apply to state and local governments. Justice Stevens, knowing that he'd be leaving the court very soon after this decision, wrote a lengthy dissent defending his view that it's a living constitution. Not surprisingly, that produced a response from Justice Scalia, who defended his view of, I guess what could be called, a dead constitution. But the result of these two cases is that the Supreme Court held that the Second Amendment can be used to challenge federal, state, and local laws, that it does protect a right of individuals to have guns in the home for the sake of security. Justice Alito's plurality opinion in McDonald reiterated what the court had said in Heller, that all the court had found was a Second Amendment right to have guns in the home for the sake of security, and that the government could regulate who had guns, where the guns were located, and what type of weapons people possess. So when you hear people talk about the law of the Second Amendment, I have now described it to you. I've tried to describe it to you as neutrally and as fairly as I can, but that's all the Supreme Court has said to this point. Anything else about what this means, in terms of regulations, what's allowed and what's not, is a matter of argument, a matter of interpretation, a matter of lower court decisions, but not a matter of Supreme Court rulings. So this brings me to the second question that I was going to ask. What are the unresolved issues? There are literally now, I was going to say dozens and dozens, but hundreds would be more accurate, of lower court opinions ruling on various questions concerning the meaning of the Second Amendment. What is striking is that the Supreme Court has had many occasions in the last 4 years to review these decisions, and without exception, has denied review in all of these cases. Most recently, just a few weeks ago, the Supreme Court denied review in a Second Amendment case. Sooner or later, the Supreme Court is going to have to resolve all of these unsettled issues with regard to the meaning of the Second Amendment, but it's clear that the Supreme Court is in no hurry to do so. We can speculate as to why not. Perhaps it's strategic choices on the part of the justices, being uncertain of where the court will come out. Perhaps a desire to allow the issues to percolate more in the lower courts. But time and again over the last 4 years, as cases have come to the Supreme Court, guarded the meaning of the Second Amendment, the justices have denied review. Well, I want to focus on three somewhat interrelated, unresolved issues with regard to the meaning of the Second Amendment. What level of scrutiny is used in evaluating government regulation of firearms? Does the Second Amendment protect a right to have firearms outside the home? And what types of government regulations are allowed? Let me start with the first of these questions. What level of scrutiny is used in evaluating government regulations of firearms? If you're not a lawyer, this phrase, level of scrutiny, may not have meaning or context, but it's really the most important question in terms of deciding what kind of laws will be allowed with regard to government regulation of firearms. To understand this, you need to know that not all claims of rights, not all types of discrimination, are treated the same under the Constitution. There are times when the court is very deferential to the government, and times when the court is very suspicious of the government. Let me start with equal protection to illustrate this. I have a 15-year-old daughter. There's nothing in the world she wants more than her driver's license. Imagine she were to bring a lawsuit saying that the California statute that says you have to be 16 to have a driver's license denies her equal protection laws. She says she's discriminated against. I assure you, if she could, she would bring that lawsuit in an instant. She would lose. Now, the reason is, the Supreme Court would say, when it comes to age discrimination like this, the government should be upheld so long as it's acting reasonably. In fact, the technical language here is that a rational basis test is used. So long as the government action is rationally related to some legitimate government purpose, the government action will be upheld. Now, at the opposite end of the continuum, if a state would adopt an abhorrent law saying no African Americans can have driver's licenses, the court would be highly suspicious, undoubtedly declare that unconstitutional, and use what is called strict scrutiny. That is, the government action will be upheld only if it is necessary to achieve a compelling government purpose. Notice that the government's goal has to be something more than just legitimate for the government to do. It has to be truly vital, compelling. The means have to be necessary. The government has to show there's no less restrictive alternative to achieve its goal. Now, in between what I've called the rational basis test and strict scrutiny, the Supreme Court has crafted what it's called intermediate scrutiny. So, for example, the Supreme Court has said that gender discrimination has to meet intermediate scrutiny. And the test of intermediate scrutiny is that the government action has to be substantially related to an important government purpose. Well, the same framework is used with regard to claims of rights. If somebody, for example, were to claim a right to welfare under a state law or a federal law, since no such right exists, the court would say the distinctions that the government draws as to who can get welfare and who can't are upheld so long as they're reasonable. If one of my students wants to challenge the restrictions that are imposed on who can get a license to practice law, the court will say there's no right to be a lawyer. Restrictions are upheld so long as they're reasonable. But if somebody invokes a fundamental right, like, say, the right to vote, the right to interstate travel, then strict scrutiny has to be met. The government action is necessary to achieve a compelling purpose. I go through all of this because it's an unresolved question as to what level of scrutiny will be used in evaluating government regulations of firearms. The more deferential the level of scrutiny, the closer to rational basis review, the more regulations that will be upheld. The more exacting the level of scrutiny, the closer to strict scrutiny, the fewer of the government regulations will be upheld. And the Supreme Court in Heller and McDonald simply does not say the level of scrutiny. There is a footnote in Justice Scalia's majority opinion in Heller which indicates that more than rational basis review will be used. But that still leaves a great deal of territory. How much deference? How exacting will the review be? The lower courts are split on this. To my knowledge, there's only one court, a federal district court in Utah, that has explicitly said that strict scrutiny should be used for all government regulation of guns. There are a number of federal courts of appeals, the Third Circuit, the Fourth Circuit, the D.C. Circuit, that have said that intermediate scrutiny should be used for government regulation of guns. Some courts have tried to avoid this by saying some kind of sliding scale or balancing test will be used. The Second Circuit, the Ninth Circuit have said this. Now, whereas the levels of scrutiny tend to be used both for equal protection claims and claims of rights, one exception to that is in the area of abortion rights. In 1992, in Planned Parenthood versus Casey, the Supreme Court said that the government can regulate abortions before viability so long as not place an undue burden on the right. Some commentators have said, well, perhaps that's the test that should be used with regard to guns. Others have argued for some form of reasonableness test, though I think that would be the hardest to reconcile with the footnote in Justice Scalia's opinion. So when I raised the issue of what's the level of scrutiny, I know I'm talking about a relatively seemingly technical question, but it is the issue that will make an enormous difference to how courts evaluate gun control laws and gun regulations of all sort. My own sense of where the court's likely to go is both to reject rational basis review and to reject strict scrutiny. I already mentioned Justice Scalia has a footnote in Heller rejecting rational basis review. I think the language in Heller and McDonald talking about the ability to regulate who has guns, where they have them, and the type of weapons also would be incompatible with strict scrutiny. So I think something either akin to or exactly like intermediate scrutiny is likely to be what emerges, which ultimately would be a balancing test between the government's justification for having the regulation and the intrusion on the right of individuals to have guns. Well, that leads to the second unresolved question. Is there a right to have guns outside the home? In presenting Heller and McDonald to you, I emphasized that the Supreme Court held only that there's a right to have guns in the home for the sake of security. The issue is unresolved by the Supreme Court as to whether there's any right of individuals to have guns outside the home. The lower courts are split on this as well. I count at least 9 lower court decisions, primarily at the federal district court level, that have held that the Second Amendment is only a right to have guns in the home for the sake of personal security. But there are a number of courts, including at the Federal Court of Appeals level, that have said that there is a Second Amendment right to have guns outside the home. I think there are strong arguments on both sides of this dispute. I think with regard to the former, the home is treated differently under the Constitution. The Fourth Amendment, for example, provides special protection of privacy in the home. Also, to the extent that the court is concerned about safety and security, the home is a special place. If the court is going to be originalist, there's an argument that the drafters of the Second Amendment, to the extent they were concerned about security, were focused on the home. On the other hand, the courts that reject this and find a Second Amendment right to have guns outside the home argue that what the Supreme Court is focused on is a right to have guns for the sake of security. Security interests exist even when people are outside of their home, and thus it should be extended to a right outside the house. Now, in talking about the meaning and myths of the Second Amendment, the meaning at this point is that the Second Amendment is just about a right to have guns in the home. If I was to offer a prediction, though, I think it's likely the court will, at least in some limited fashion, say there's a right to have guns outside the home, though that can be regulated. Well, this then leads me to the third and final question that I want to address. What types of government regulations are allowed? Now, I put this last because obviously the answer to this question is going to turn on the prior two. What regulations will be allowed will depend on the level of scrutiny. What regulation will be allowed will depend on whether it's a right only in the home or outside of the home. There are dozens and dozens of different kinds of gun regulations that exist in the United States. It shouldn't surprise you that there have been lawsuits challenging all of them. And so, as I said, there are hundreds of lower court decisions. What is most striking to me is that the vast, vast majority of these decisions have upheld the regulations. I can probably count on less than the fingers of one hand the number of cases that have struck down government regulations of guns. Again, when we talk about the meaning and myths of the Second Amendment, the myth would be that most gun regulations are unconstitutional. The meaning has been that most gun regulations have been upheld. Let me give you six examples of types of gun regulations and what the lower courts have said about them. I'll cover them relatively briefly because time is short. One type of gun regulation is laws that limit carrying of concealed weapons. The California law is typical in this regard. California has a statute that prohibits the carrying of concealed weapons, but allows counties to grant permits to individuals to have concealed weapons where they live or where they work. A county can grant such a permit if three requirements are met. First, the person has to be shown to be good moral character. Second, the person has to have firearms training. And third, there has to be good cause for a concealed weapons permit. As I said, such laws are common throughout the United States. Many circuits have upheld exactly this kind of a law. The Second Circuit, for example, has upheld this kind of a statute. However, just a couple of weeks ago, the Ninth Circuit in Peruta versus County of San Diego declared unconstitutional this California law, and specifically the requirement that a person has to have good cause to get a concealed weapons permit. It is quite important understanding this case to know that the two judges in the majority of the 2-1 decision were quite conservative. Judge Deramiddo Scanlon, who wrote the opinion, is one of the most conservative judges on the Ninth Circuit in any federal court of appeals, and also one of the judges who's been most consistently pro-gun rights. He was joined by Judge Consuelo Callahan. The dissent was by Judge Sidney Thomas. Judge O'Scanlon's majority opinion for the Ninth Circuit said that the Second Amendment does create a right of individuals to have guns outside of the home. He said that California prohibits the open carrying of weapons, therefore to also restrict the carrying of concealed weapons to those with good cause violates the Second Amendment. Judge Thomas wrote a very strong dissenting opinion. He pointed out that in 1897, the Supreme Court had upheld laws that prohibit the carrying of concealed weapons. Also, in Justice Scalia's majority opinion in Heller, he specifically gave laws that restrict carrying of concealed weapons as an example of the type of regulations that would be allowed. Concealed weapons pose particular dangers. In fact, when the Supreme Court in Terry versus Ohio in 1968 upheld stop and frisk under the Fourth Amendment, Justice Harlan, a concurring decision, gave as a reason the need to check for concealed weapons because of their greater danger. I am always reluctant to make predictions about what the courts will do. I long ago learned that he who lives by the crystal ball has to learn to eat ground glass. But I will make a prediction here, and that is that the Ninth Circuit will grant en banc review of this decision, that is review by, in the Ninth Circuit, it's not the whole court, it's 11 judges of the Ninth Circuit, and I believe that in all likelihood the Ninth Circuit will overrule the panel decision, though obviously that will depend on who the 11 judges are. The matter will then, whether it's this case or another, go to the Supreme Court. Harder to predict what the Supreme Court will do. My instinct is that the Supreme Court will allow the government to ban carrying of concealed weapons. I can't see the Supreme Court finding a Second Amendment right to have concealed weapons. And also, the language in Justice Scalia's opinion in Heller, remember, said that laws prohibiting concealed weapons are an example of the type of statutes that are permitted. Second, there are regulations of who can have guns. These laws, almost without exception, have been consistently upheld in the lower courts. So, as was already mentioned, there's a federal law that prohibits those who have been convicted of domestic violence crimes, including misdemeanor crimes, from having guns. This has been consistently upheld in the lower courts. There are laws that prohibit those who have felony convictions from having guns. These have been consistently upheld in the lower courts. There are laws that prevent those who have been involuntarily committed to a mental institution with guns. These have been consistently upheld in the lower courts. I think so long as the regulation of who has guns is reasonable, the lower courts are likely to uphold them. A third type of regulation are background checks and registration. Already been talked about how there are laws requiring background checks, those significant loopholes in them for private sale of guns and gun shows, and there are also possibility of registration laws. Again, every lower court, to my knowledge, to consider the constitutionality of background checks and registrations, have upheld those forms of gun regulation. It is easy to see why they're constitutional under Heller and McDonald. Once the Supreme Court says the government can regulate who has guns, keeping those with a felony conviction or those with a history of mental illness with guns, it then makes sense that the government also can do the background checks to make sure that it's not giving a gun permit to those who aren't allowed to have the firearms. A fourth kind of regulation that's been tried, safety regulations. These have already been mentioned. These are laws, like the Florida statute that's mentioned, that require the safekeeping of guns to limit the ability of children to have access to it. These are laws that require that individuals have training in order to have a gun, that they have to go to a firing range to be able to get this kind of a training. Overwhelmingly, these laws, too, have been upheld, the only exception being a Seventh Circuit case, Azell versus City of Chicago. Chicago had an ordinance that said that a person could have a gun permit only if they had completed firing range training, but Chicago prohibited all firing ranges in the city of Chicago, and under those circumstances, the Seventh Circuit said this was unconstitutional. But here, too, I think, so long as it is a reasonable safety regulation, is like to be upheld. A fifth type of regulation concerns the types of weapons. There are laws that restrict certain kind of martial arts weapons. There are laws that regulate the high-capacity magazine clips. There are laws, of course, that prohibit assault rifles or semi-assault rifles. Without exception, each and every one of these laws has been upheld by the lower courts, even after Heller and McDonald. And sixth and finally, there are the laws that regulate the location of weapons, prohibiting weapons in particular places. There's a federal law that prohibits having firearms in national parks. The Fourth Circuit has upheld that. There's regulations, federal law that prohibits having weapons on Postal Service property. Laws have upheld that. And of course, laws prohibit guns in places like airports and schools. Heller makes clear such laws are permissible. So as you leave here today, in terms of your understanding of the meaning of the Second Amendment, it's key that you remember that almost all of the regulations that federal, state, and local governments have tried have been allowed and are likely to be allowed in the future. So then to conclude by addressing what I was asked to talk about, what's the meaning, what are the myths of the Second Amendment? The meaning of the Second Amendment at this point is that individuals have a right to have guns in their home for the sake of security. The myths regard to the Second Amendment are when people tell you that the government can't regulate who has guns, or the government can't regulate what type of weapons they have, or the government can't regulate where those guns are located. All of those are things that can be regulated, even under Heller and McDonald, and are likely to be regulated into the future. Thank you.
Erwin, thank you. During the first half of Erwin's comments, I spent making a long list of questions that I wanted to ask based on his comments. I spent the last half, unfortunately, of his remarks crossing each of those questions out as he answered them. our final speaker for this part of the program is John Lowy. who is director of the Legal Action Project at the Brady Center to Prevent Gun Violence. John.
Okay. Thank you all. Not sure if we can. I think we need a scientist to get the PowerPoint working. But I can. If it doesn't, I will just proceed. Well, I wanted to begin where Rich Negrin so powerfully started this day, talking about the costs and faces of gun violence. I want to talk to you about some of those costs and faces and the people behind them, how gun tragedies happen, and what we in the legal community can do about it. An 8-year-old boy in Kansas, his home and bed, when he is shot and killed by his father. A high school basketball player in Buffalo is shooting hoops when he is gunned down by a gang member. A 15-year-old boy in California visiting his 14-year-old friend is accidentally shot and killed. And a woman in Chicago walking home from work is shot dead by a stalker in the parking lot of her workplace. Two police officers in Milwaukee shot while on duty. And just a few miles away from here, a young boy finds a gun literally on the streets, picks it up thinking it is a toy, and pulls the trigger, killing his friend. Now, let me tell you how these tragedies happened. In every one of these incidents, the shooter was prohibited from buying a gun. He could not get a gun legally. He needed an illegal source, and irresponsible gun companies were happy to supply that source, either directly or indirectly, and profit off it. The father in Kansas, for example, was a convicted felon, and when he went to the gun to the store to buy the gun to kill his son, he told the gun dealer that he was a felon. So the gun dealer simply turned to the woman he was with, who was his grandmother, sold the gun to her, and he walked out with the murder weapon, an obvious straw purchase. The gang member who shot the high school basketball player in Buffalo got his gun from a gun trafficker. A gun dealer in Ohio supplied that trafficker with over 180 Saturday Night Special handguns, all sold in cash, all sold in bulk sales. In fact, the gun used to shoot the high school student was sold in an 87 handgun purchase. The stalker that killed the woman in Chicago found his illegal gun on the internet at armslist.com, a virtual gun show online. How can this happen? For one, as Julie explained, our laws allow it to happen. There are no limits on how many guns you can sell. There are no background checks required for private, unlicensed sales. Websites and gun shows exploit this loophole. And ATF, which is charged with regulating gun dealers, is underfunded and reined in by gun lobby-pushed restrictions. And irresponsible gun companies take advantage to make a dollar. Let me read you some testimony from a lawsuit that we brought. You can hear straight from the gun dealer's mouth about how this happens. And this is from a man who worked in a gun store in Texas. He's asked, did you ever have occasion for customers to volunteer information of prior convictions? Answer, yes, sir. Question, what would they be doing this in connection with? Answer, well, the Brady form you fill out is a background check. And even on the yellow form, I've had customers volunteer, quote, well, I had this conviction. Or I've been asked, quote, can this stop me from buying a gun? If the answer is yes, we were directed on several occasions, find out if they've got somebody with them or can get somebody to come do the legal work to buy the gun. question. And on those occasions when somebody volunteered they had a prior conviction, what was your experience as to what happened then? Answer, if management knew it, that is gun dealer management, the question was put out, quote, do you have someone that can do it for you? And the high number salesman, it was a practice, like I'll hold this gun, you bring somebody. I specifically was talked to one time because I did turn down, send a guy out the door, and it was a high dollar semi-automatic pistol, and I said, it just, it's not gonna happen with me, and I know I was told that, quote, well, you know, we're dealing numbers and profit. That's sworn testimony from a clerk at one of the largest gun stores in Texas. Now, let me tell you what we in the legal community can do about some of these tragedies to help prevent them. You see, these stories are just some of the lawsuits that we at the Brady Center's Legal Action Project have brought over the past 25 years. And we continue to bring them across the country. We hold gun dealers, manufacturers accountable for their contribution to gun violence. We defend strong, sensible gun laws, and we challenge and defeat overbroad or unconstitutional laws, some of the laws that Julie referred to as crazy laws, which I agree with her analysis. And in fact, we've brought suit against some of the ones that she mentioned. We've won precedents in courts across the country holding that negligent gun companies can be accountable for their contribution to gun violence. Now, to be clear, most gun dealers are responsible business people. And in fact, this is an ATF chart, you will see that over 85% of gun dealers sell zero guns traced and recovered in crime in a given year. But as Jan Vernick pointed out, about 1% of gun dealers sell over 57% of the crime guns. These are the bad apple gun dealers. And someone asked, what can we do about it? Well, in our lawsuits against some of these bad apple gun dealers, where ATF, to be frank, has not done what it should do to get them out of business, we've brought lawsuits, and we have gotten some out of business. In fact, in a lawsuit here in Philadelphia against what was then one of the top suppliers of crime guns, Lewes Loans, after we brought a lawsuit against Lewes, ATF finally took action and got their license revoked and put them out of business. We also fight to get gun companies to put in safety devices to prevent unintentional shootings. And there was some discussion about how these devices can save lives. And as Julie pointed out, because guns are exempt from the Consumer Product Safety Act, the federal government cannot force gun manufacturers to put in safety devices. But lawsuits can provide powerful financial incentives for them to do what they should be doing all along. Unfortunately, gun companies, manufacturers, do not on their own do the right thing and make their guns safer. And again, I'd like you to hear from the industry itself. This is testimony by an expert of Beretta in a lawsuit actually on behalf of the California teenager who you saw earlier who was shot and killed unintentionally by one of his best friends. The expert was asked in this case how he weighed the risks and benefits of safety devices and firearms. And he's asked, and I'll cut to the chase in a lengthy question, quote, how in this weighing process do you consider the loss of life? And this is what he told the jury on behalf of the gun manufacturer, quote, the fact that someone may be killed based on a decision I've made, as a matter of fact, I could say it in a different way that even sounds worse. I know that some people will be killed because of decisions that I have made. For instance, the one we talked about with the magazine disconnector safety. Some people in accident cases that I've dealt with have been killed, and they wouldn't have been killed if that magazine safety had been in place. But I have to try to think about all the ways that this item is going to be used. Now, the magazine disconnect safety that he's talking about is a device that prevents a gun from firing when the ammunition magazine is removed from it. And there are many times where people think that the gun is unloaded because the magazine's been removed, but in fact, there's a round in the chamber. So the expert goes on to explain what are the great benefits that outweigh the loss of the lives of children. And he says, quote, if you are backpacking off into the wilderness and you're going to maybe rely on that to shoot at some snakes or shoot rabbits to eat or whatever the heck, and you lose your magazine or damage it so it doesn't work, if it's got a device in there that prevents you from shooting it with the magazine out, you can't use the gun anymore. But you could still, if it didn't have that device, you could still load it one at a time and still shoot it. Close quote. So in the position of Beretta, the gun manufacturer, was that the benefit of being able to shoot snakes and rabbits, if you needed that to survive, outweighed what he admitted was the certain deaths of children that could have been prevented by these safety devices. Again, that's a judgment that's made by many gun manufacturers in America, but litigation on behalf of victims can provide financial incentives for them to do the right thing. Additionally, we challenge laws that hinder gun violence prevention and infringe on other rights. As I mentioned, and Julie mentioned, what's called the Docs v. Glocks case. That's not the official caption, but that's what we call it, where Florida passed a law which would authorize the revocation of doctors' medical licenses if they simply talk to their patients about the risks of guns, which, by the way, is the recommended protocol from the American Academy of Pediatrics. So if a pediatrician was doing her job, she could get her license revoked. We brought a lawsuit against that law on First Amendment grounds, got an injunction, and as Julie mentioned, it was argued in the 11th Circuit this past summer, and we're awaiting a decision. Nelson, Georgia, passed an ordinance which required heads of households to have a functional firearm in the home. We brought a lawsuit against that, claiming, among other things, it was a violation of the Second Amendment, because we argued that part of the Second Amendment right to protect yourself in the home included the right to keep guns out of the home. And in fact, most Americans choose to protect their families by keeping guns out rather than bringing them in. And we got a settlement in which Nelson agreed to never enforce the ordinance and recognized our position. We also help defend jurisdictions whose laws have been challenged, usually on Second Amendment grounds. This is some of the pertinent language, but I think Dean Chemerinsky summarized it much better than I could. And I would note that when we're involved in these litigations, and if I assume any of you are lawyers in the crowd here, we don't just file amicus briefs like some, like many organizations. We actually go into court, in some cases represent jurisdictions. We represented, in fact, the city of Pittsburgh when the NRA sued it for to try to strike down their lost and stolen gun ordinance. We assisted Philadelphia in defense of their gun ordinances, and we continue to do that around the country. And so if you're interested, and I hope you are, in working in this area, I would invite you to go to our website and join lawyersforsaferamerica.org, which is a national alliance of lawyers and law firms that is growing, which invites lawyers to work with us and work with victims of gun violence, work with cities, counties, states whose laws are challenged, and make a difference. This is extraordinarily exciting, fulfilling work. It has the opportunity to really create new constitutional law in the Second Amendment area, but also in the First Amendment area, and certainly in the tort liability area. And most importantly, it has the opportunity to save lives, such as Nafis Jefferson, this young man. So thank you very much.
Instead of having questions for this panel immediately, we're going to have our next speaker and then come back for the questions for this panel, if that's all right. Please.
Thank you very much. My name is Shira Goodman, Director of Ceasefire PA. I'll be back on the next panel. I'm privileged today to introduce to you somebody who probably doesn't need introduction to a lot of folks in the room. He has been a great Philadelphian, a great Pennsylvanian. He was mayor of Philadelphia. He was known as America's mayor. He's governor of Pennsylvania, and he has been a champion for gun violence prevention. Since I started Ceasefire PA, every time we have asked of him to do something, he has been there with us, standing with Pennsylvanians who want better laws and better policies. He has been a leader in this, and we're so lucky to have Governor Edward G. Rendell as a partner.
Hello, everyone. Thank you. You are way behind in your time schedule, and I looked at the program, and this panel was supposed to go for an hour and 25 minutes, and the next panel is for an hour and 5 minutes, and I've been allotted 15 minutes, so I described to my office staff that I was like a sorbet that's given to clean your palate. So given the fact that you're behind schedule, I'm gonna even shorten it a little bit. My talk is entitled "The Need for Action," and for those of us who've been fighting this issue for a long time, or for those of us who've been just recently to the issue, propelled by what happened in Connecticut or whatever, it's very frustrating to see what happens in state capitals, frustrating to, obviously, to see what doesn't happen in Washington. But I believe there is a road that we need to get on that can produce significant action. Let me posit a question to all of you. Heidi Heitkamp was a Democratic senator elected in the 2012 election, and she was one of the six Democrats who voted against universal background checks. She voted against universal background checks, notwithstanding the fact that the poll by the largest newspaper in North Dakota found 93% of North Dakotans in favor of universal background checks, including almost 7 out of 10 NRA members. Kelly Ayotte is a moderate Republican senator from New Hampshire. She voted against universal background checks, even though a poll by the Manchester Guardian found that 90% of New Hampshireans, including 75% of Republicans, favored universal background checks. Now, why in Lord's name would two relatively sane, relatively intelligent senators vote against the wishes of over 9 out of 10 of their constituents? Because the NRA and the people who follow the NRA's dictates are single issue voters. They vote on one issue, and that is how you, if you're a legislator or a governor, what your stance was on efforts to curb gun violence. And they can target individuals and make a difference. The reason that it seems ludicrous to me to cast these votes, and the reason it would seem ludicrous to you, doesn't seem ludicrous to them, because they know that, and most politicians are visceral. So on an issue like this, my guess is that Kelly Ayotte and Heidi Heitkamp received well over 1,000 emails and well over 2,000 or 3,000 phone calls to their office in the days leading up to the vote from Second Amendment rights people. My guess is they received less than 20% of that from people who wanted them to vote aye on the bill. We tend to be the people who believe that we should have rational gun safety laws. We tend not to be single issue voters. And the call for action, or the need for action, is very simple. We've got to become single-issue voters. As much as that might hurt, we've got to become single-issue voters. Mayor Bloomberg was criticized roundly by progressives and Democrats when he called for New Yorkers to boycott fundraisers for the six Democrats who voted against universal background checks. And literally, people were saying, well, Mayor Bloomberg's going to try to turn his actions will help turn the Senate over to conservative Republican leadership. And I said, maybe, but Mayor Bloomberg's message is the right message. There have to be consequences. Heidi Heitkamp believes she can do what she did and suffer no consequences from all of the supporters of Democrats and progressive causes. But she knows that there will be consequences if, in fact, she voted the other way. Same thing with Kelly Ayotte. And we've got to become single-issue voters. No ifs, ands, and buts about it. This has to be the issue that drives us. It can't be an amalgam of issues. Until we become single-issue voters and strike the same fear into elected officials that they exist when the NRA opposes them, nothing is going to change. Either that or we need to get the law changed so there can be secret ballots. If there was a secret ballot on universal background checks, it would have gotten over 80 votes in the Senate. But our senators are scared. They're a bunch of wusses when it comes to taking difficult action. And we've got to change that, plain and simple as that. No ifs, ands, and buts about it. It has to happen. Secondly, we've got to try to talk some degree of rationality into the legislators, both in state legislatures and in Washington. The NRA is not as powerful as they think. Most of you think that the NRA gives out a whole boatload of money in Washington, right? The NRA in the 2012 cycle gave out less than $2 million. There were 147 groups that gave out more money than the NRA. But they give it in targeted ways. And again, it strikes up that fear factor. I was a strong gun control advocate when I was mayor of Philadelphia, when I was district attorney of Philadelphia. And when I ran for governor in 2002, I ran in the Democratic primary against Bob Casey. The NRA strongly supported Bob Casey, sent out direct mail, did radio ads. I won the primary. When I ran for governor in the general election, they supported the Republican candidate. When I ran for re-election as governor, they supported the Republican candidate. Pennsylvania is not a blue state. If you're from out of Pennsylvania and you think about recent presidential elections, you say, well, Pennsylvania is becoming a blue state. Not true. Only in presidential elections when there's a mass turnout. In other elections, well, as we meet here today, Pennsylvania has a Republican governor, a Republican state senate, a Republican state house, and one Republican senator. It's very much a purple state, and yet I was reelected over the vociferous and strong opposition of the NRA. I won the primary by 12 percentage points. I won the first general election by 10 percentage points. I won the second general election by 21 percentage points, in spite of the strong opposition of the NRA in the state that has the second highest NRA membership in the union, only second to Pennsylvania. So what does that tell you about the NRA? First of all, a lot of NRA members don't follow the political line of the NRA, as you can tell from the polls on universal background checks. A lot of NRA members do it because they want the magazine and they want the discounts. That's why they join. Simple as that. They aren't apostles of the NRA philosophy. Plus the fact is they see the NRA philosophy change with the wind. They were for universal background checks not very long ago, but that totally changed after Newtown. So we've got to convince our wuss politicians to not be afraid, that they're not as powerful as you think, but we've got to become single-issue voters. That's the start and the finish of it. And we've got to push our own legislative agenda. I thought that the Democrats and the president gave up on other parts of the legislation too easily. The only thing they pushed was universal background checks. I would have liked to have seen them push for the reinstatement of the ban on high-capacity magazines that was in the assault weapons bill. One reason was because we can prove it works. You know, the NRA is always saying, well, all these people in these mass murders, the guns are acquired legally, so none of this stuff would make a difference. In Newtown, the mother purchased the gun. She had every right to purchase the gun. Universal background checks wouldn't have stopped that at all. Well, let's take a look at High Capacity Magazine. You all remember the incident in Tucson where 12 people were injured, 7 were killed. Among the people killed was the 9-year-old girl whose sole mistake was her hero was not an actress or a sports star. Her hero was Congressman Gabby Giffords, and she wanted to meet her congressman, so she went out to the shopping center, and she was shot dead. Gabby Giffords was almost killed, and the fact situation in that case was Jared Loughner had a 33-bullet magazine in his gun when he opened up and hit 19 people, 14 shots missed. He then took out the magazine that was spent and was reaching for a second magazine, took it out of his back pocket, another 33-shot magazine, when a courageous older woman belted his arm with her pocketbook, dislodging the magazine and allowing two guys who were standing nearby to jump him and disarm him and immobilize him until he was taken into custody. Assume that the assault weapons ban was still in effect, and assume the first magazine that Loughner put into his gun was 10 bullets, which was the law at the time. He couldn't have hit 19 people. If you assume his accuracy would have been the same, he would have hit 6 people. So some who were killed would have survived, some who were injured would have not been hit at all. It would have made a dramatic difference. Maybe that 9-year-old girl would still be alive today, because obviously the same fact pattern would have happened. When he's finished with the 10 shots, he would have tried to reload. The woman would have done the same thing, and the guys would have done the same thing once the second magazine fell to the ground. It makes a difference. And what we need to do is start putting pressure on moderate Democrats and moderate Republicans, there are some left, and conservative Democrats. We need to force a vote. Now, with the Republicans in control of the House, you say, and the Speaker decides which bills go to the floor, how can we do that? Well, you might have heard talk about immigration about something called a discharge petition. We need to send around a discharge petition. Every Democrat should sign the discharge petition, and then it should be taken to the Republicans. And by the way, if a majority of members of the House sign a discharge petition, the bill goes immediately to the floor and is voted on without amendment. So, we have 4 so-called moderate Republican congressmen in this area: Congressman Gerlach in Montgomery County, Congressman Fitzpatrick in Bucks County, Congressman Meehan in Delaware County, and Congressman Dent in the Lehigh Valley. They all were able to say, yes, we support universal background checks. They said that in a letter to the newspaper. But they never had to really put up or shut up. If discharge petition, they would have either had to go against their own speaker, go against their own caucus, or sign it. If they sign it, we get it to the floor and we get a vote. And I believe if that bill went to the floor, it would pass. If they don't sign it, then we've got them for what they are: too scared to buck the NRA, too scared to buck their own party. And then we have a shot to remove them in the next election. We've got to be aggressive. We've got to be creative. We've got to be aggressive. And we've got to be single-issue voters. Again, there's no other pathway. It has to be all-out war. We've been fighting this battle with 1 and maybe 1.5 of our arms tied behind our back. We've got to use every arrow in our quiver if we really want to make a dent. And the stakes are, I heard the last speaker talk about the difference in the Beretta executive's attitude and about saving lives. The stakes are real. I mean, when I spoke out at Villanova at Operation Ceasefire, Shira asked me to speak at Villanova. The good news was it was in December. I thought we'd have 15, 20 people there. We had 200 people, and every seat in the auditorium was packed. But there was a traveling exhibit that was on display upstairs. It was a portrait that this incredible portrait painter had done of every one of the children who were killed at Newtown. And the portraits were incredible. They looked like photographs. And they were up on the wall, all next to each other, about two-thirds of the screen. It was about as big as two-thirds of the screen. You see that portrait, and you know what the stakes are. We can't hesitate. It's war, and it's a war that we've got to win. And I believe it's a war that we can win, because the American people are behind us in so many different ways. The American people want it to stop. Unfortunately, you know it's likely that there'll be another Newtown, or there'll be another Tucson, or there'll be another Aurora. And then what happens? You know, we've become great at the aftermath of these mass killings. The president or the governor comes out, and there's a ceremony of remembrance, and everyone talks about how great the first responders were. Everyone talks about the bravery of the teachers and or the people who were involved in trying to help. And the president gives a great speech, and we all engage in prayer, and nothing changes until the next incident. And then we have another ceremony. I don't know about you, but I'm sick of it. Thank you.
I want to start with one question, actually, for Irwin.
Sure.
Under the Heller case, what parts of the legislation considered by Congress after Newtown would have been unconstitutional, if any?
I think it all would have been clearly constitutional. I don't think there was anything that was proposed there that would have been unconstitutional. I mean, the core part was, of course, universal background checks, as Governor Rendell was just saying. And there's no doubt that background checks are constitutional. I don't know of any court that's invalidated them.
I think that's a strong message that lawyers have a responsibility to get out what is constitutional here and what is not. There was so much bad information put out by the gun lobby about the constitutionality of the legislation considered after Newtown. Lawyers have a responsibility to address that. Excuse me while I read these for the first time. Okay, John, this one's for you. You mentioned defending lost and stolen laws. How many times have these laws been used?
Have they been used?
That's the phrase of the question.
Not certain what it means, but I don't think I have an answer for it. But just let me just explain briefly about lost and stolen guns. Basically, what these laws require is simply if you're a gun owner and your gun, you find out that your gun is lost or stolen, you don't know where it is. In a timely fashion, usually something like 48 hours, you have to report that to law enforcement. And the reason is, one, if you're telling the truth, there is a gun out there in criminal hands, criminal because it was a thief who took it, but also because a lot of times you're not telling the truth. And what we've seen is that many gun traffickers buy guns in order to supply them to somebody else, and then when the gun is finally recovered and traced on the streets by law enforcement, they come back to you who bought the gun and say, where is it? And you say, must be lost or stolen. Now, if you had a lost or stolen reporting requirement, then you couldn't get away with that sort of alibi.
Good. Last question, and I'm sorry that we won't be able to read all of these. And this is for anyone on the panel. Do any other countries in the world have a Second Amendment kind of equivalent law, constitutional provision?
No, they do not.
But I just briefly, I mean, you know, England did have the Bill of Rights, which is similar, and in fact, the Heller Court recognized that the Second Amendment came from the British rights, and yet in England, construing that same, you know, predecessor of the Second Amendment, they've allowed for extensive, you know, gun regulations, including, you know, pretty much banning, for all practical purposes, handguns. So I think that's worth noting in construing what the meaning of the Second Amendment is.
Great. Well, please join me again in thanking our panelists.
You can go into a gun store, and if you pass your background check, you leave with a gun. There's no license, there's no registration, there's no training, there's no waiting period. There's no limit on what you can buy or how much you can buy. Ammunition is virtually unregulated. Except for Philadelphia, which is a little bit of a special case, we are an open carry state. Concealed carry with a permit that you can get either from the county sheriff, or if you live in Philadelphia, from the Philadelphia Police Department. We have had some progress in the year since Newtown. Pennsylvania went from being among the worst states in the nation in terms of getting our mental health records into the national database to one of the best. That happened just over a year ago with little fanfare from the state police and governor's office that made it happen, but to much attention from organizations like mine and many of the ones up here. We knew that was a big deal for Pennsylvania to go and share 642,000 missing mental health records. Also last year, our new Attorney General, Kathleen Kane, made it clear that if you want to carry a concealed weapon in Pennsylvania and you are a Pennsylvania resident, you need to get a permit here. You cannot go to Florida, go online to Florida or Virginia or somewhere else and get one. That's another big step. And also, and Governor Rendell spent a lot of time talking about this, both of Pennsylvania's senators supported the background check bill. And not only did they support it, but Senator Toomey put his name on it. That is a tremendously huge deal here in Pennsylvania, not something that would have been expected to happen. So we've had some progress. We are not one of the states that has been passing bad laws since Newtown, nor have we passed our agenda, which is a broad agenda to expand background checks and close our private seller loophole, which applies to long guns here, to get a statewide lost or stolen reporting requirement, to have a limit on high capacity magazines, and to fight the restrictive preemption laws that harness what state towns and municipalities can do. So we have a lot to do, but we also have things to be hopeful for. And as the governor mentioned, he talked about the federal elections, but we have a lot of people right now who would like to be your new governor, who would like to be your new representative in Harrisburg or Washington, and you should be asking them where they stand on this. Ceasefire PA is doing some of that, and we'll soon be issuing a report about the candidates running for governor. But we encourage you to be sending those emails, sending those letters. Earlier this week, we sent, and many of you got it, an email asking you to write again to your legislator about expanding background checks, and hundreds of you already have. So we need to keep up that pressure. We know that we are a majority. We have been silent for too long, but we know that's changing too. So that's a little bit of overview of what's happening in Pennsylvania. I'm going to go down and ask each of the panelists to talk, and then hopefully we'll get to talk to each other. I'm going to start with Deputy Commissioner Bethel from the Philadelphia Police Department. And can you tell us, sir, there's some good news in Philadelphia, right?
Oh, it's all good news, all good news. Well, good evening, well, early evening. So just to give you an overview, I mean, Philadelphia, we've really had a successful year, despite the issues that we have with the gun laws and how we wish they would be. We feel confident that our strategies and our efforts to abate the violence is working. Acknowledge my boss, Commissioner Ross, is in the back, and so he's in the back there with me. So last year we had probably one of our best years that we've had since 1967. We had 247 homicides. Now, many of you may say, wow, 247 is a lot. And my friend to the left would tell you that definitely that is a lot. But considering how in the 90s and early 90s, 1990, we had 500 homicides. I was just talking to Brian earlier, you know, in 1960 it was 125, 130. And so we've made some significant strides since Commissioner Ramsey and Commissioner Ross and the team has really put forth a lot of effort to reduce the level of violence that we see in the city. Just to give you a kind of overview of what the city looks like, we have 21 patrol districts, 6 divisions. And each one of those areas, we have 12 districts that experience a significant level of violence, gun violence in particular. And of those 12, 6 of those districts run roughly over 50% of our violence occurs in there. And so gun violence is the premium focus where we spend a lot of our time and energy, unfortunately, trying to address these various pockets of violence across the city. But again, we emphasize that we've had an amount of success. Last year, we had our lowest number of shooting victims that we've had since we've been recording that number. But we also deal with a lot of gun violence as it relates to confiscations. Last year, we confiscated over 3,800 guns in the city of Philadelphia, and that's one of our lowest years. So you see the sheer volume of guns that comes into the city is enormous. But we've also been successful across our violent crime overall, and we've seen a reduction in our robberies of 26%. And I'm comparing that to 2007. You know, in 2008, Commissioner Ramsey came on board. Burglaries have been down, vehicle thefts 47%. And we use, again, a myriad of strategies to do that. You know, working, Brian, we work together. He's no longer in the DA's office in a program down in South Philadelphia, using a David Kennedy model and focusing in that area on the gang violence. We use a number of footbeat deployments, some old school deployment that goes back, but we're working with Temple University and studying our analysis of that. We've really worked hard to use that strategy. We focus on around 38 targeted areas. So when I talk to you about violence, we have 38 areas that we target specifically because of their increased level of violence, and we put a lot of manpower and time into those pockets. And we work with a number of our support groups out there, Mothers in Charge, I see down to my left, and we work a lot together. And I'll give her props here as we sit here, because all too often the groups that you'll talk about and the groups that we see on the ground, their numbers are not counted. But we definitely believe that the work and the success we've had in those reductions have come from their efforts on the ground, doing the stuff up in the prisons, talking to these young men and trying to get them to lessen their level of violence and get rid of the guns. But the gun violence continues to be a significant process for us. But we feel we have a very strong strategy under the direction of Commissioner Ramsey. And his position has always been that, you know, and I think Governor Brindell touched on that, the banning of the military-style assault weapons, the limiting of those guns, high-capacity magazines, closing the gun show loopholes. All those things are relevant. I mean, we're getting guns on the street now that are 5 and 6 years old, so we're not even getting the new guns. So even if we were to stop today and say you can no longer have a gun, it would take a number of years before those guns would ever be able to flush out of the system. So you see what we're able to do with just our efforts. I can only imagine if we had the gun laws, you know, people talk about New York and things that are going on around us. If we had those stricter gun laws, I could only imagine where we would be. Born and raised in the city of Philadelphia, I'm 50 years old, I've lived here my whole life. I've grown up in one of the toughest neighborhoods in the city and seen so much violence. And myself and Commissioner Ross will tell you, we take a lot of pride in being able to see the number we see, but that number is still too great. And we oftentimes wonder if policies were in place and people sat down and really, really understood the dynamics that we deal with on a daily basis, what those gun laws and what those restrictions would do. And we are working with the DA's office, and we're doing a much better job of keeping these individuals who do carry the guns in custody. But that's a temporary fix, and all too often, you know, these guys come back out or they get other people to take on that process. But, you know, I could only imagine, and hopefully in my career, that we would find an ability to be able to marriage up our strategies with what we think are a strong strategy with the gun laws that would help us to have an effective strategy overall and globally, that we would really, really make a difference in this city. So I applaud the efforts that are underway, and I also applaud the panelists who are here who are working to in that effort.
Thank you. And last year, maybe John Lowy remembers, we were on a panel together with Commissioner Ramsey, and he was asked about lost or stolen reporting. And I always like to quote him because he said, just report the damn gun missing. It helps. So, you know, we have a great partnership with the police department. And I want to turn it over to Brian Lentz, who's next to Deputy Commissioner. He's a former chief of the Philadelphia Regional Gun Violence Task Force.
Yeah, I want to emphasize former. I see I'm being identified that way. I don't want to get arrested for impersonating a law enforcement officer. But no, I did have the distinct honor of working with Commissioner Bethel and Commissioner Ross, and what they have done in the recent past, but also over their careers, is nothing short of miraculous. And with the folks' deterrence, but also just their overall strategic vision and execution of policing, where they're under-resourced and really are hindered by what you heard about the Pennsylvania gun laws. I spent a short stint in the Pennsylvania legislature, and anytime a gun issue would come up, after they said no, the next thing the NRA would say is you just have to enforce the laws on the books. And that, for people like Commissioner Bethel and Commissioner Ross, who spent their careers, you know, chasing bad guys down dark alleys, is pretty infuriating when you think about it, because they spend their days 24/7 enforcing the laws that exist. So the NRA, as to the police, had no leg to stand on when they said enforce the laws that they exist. They did have a leg to stand on in the courtroom. because for many years in Pennsylvania and in Philadelphia, carrying a gun illegally was a misdemeanor offense, which, like in most states, a misdemeanor offense is the second lowest offense. When I began as a prosecutor in 1993, it was a misdemeanor. It was handled by the municipal court, which is our local misdemeanor court in the city of Philadelphia. And if you were successful in getting a conviction for someone carrying a gun, and then you pounded the table and talked about what a terrible person they were, and the judge sentenced them to prison, they had an automatic right to appeal to the Court of Common Pleas. So they got a new trial. So judges had no incentive after convicting someone to give them jail time, because it would just mean a new trial, they would go to the Common Pleas level, and they would get probation. And that was the situation during the time, as Commissioner Bethel referenced, when there were 500 murders in the city of Philadelphia. 500 murders, but if you got caught carrying an illegal gun, you got out on bail, and when and if you got convicted, in 99% of the cases, you got probation. And that's, talk about tying the police's hands behind their back. That awful situation continued up until, I think, 1997, they changed it to a felony. But when they changed carrying a gun to a felony, they didn't change the sentencing guidelines to call for prison. So now it was a felony, so now they didn't get that two bites at the apple. They went right to the Common Pleas Court. But at the end of the day, when you stood in front of the judge, and if it was the first offense and they were carrying an illegal gun, the sentencing guidelines suggested probation. So now you had one step forward. You'd gotten the more serious offense, but still, the officer risking his life pursuing the armed offender was not getting a jail sentence, or in most cases, any jail time, because they were making bail. Then finally, in 2005, they changed the guidelines to call for 12 months in prison if you get caught carrying an illegal gun. But that typically was not being enforced. And so one of the initiatives that was started with the help of Ceasefire Pennsylvania was the Court Watch program, where the sentencing in a possession-only case, not a robbery, not a shooting, not a homicide, but the sentencing in a possession-only case was treated as seriously as a sentencing in those other types of cases. And that meant having Ceasefire represented, but also having Ceasefire recruit people from the community to come to the courtroom. A reporter from the Philadelphia Inquirer, Karen Heller, wrote about one of the sentencings, and she described that a gun possession sentencing was typically like a wedding where the groom had no guest and the bride had a full 8 rows of guests. The groom was the prosecutor, and the bride was the defendant. So the prosecutor would stand up and say he had an illegal gun, and he's a danger, and police officer was put at risk, and then the minister, the coach, the teacher, the mother, the cousin, et cetera, would get up and cry and say he's a good boy, let him go home, and you would get probation. So the point of the Court Watch program was to switch that dynamic. So after, not only did you have the defendant represented there, you had someone standing up and saying, look, I wasn't robbed, I wasn't shot, but I live in the community. My children can't play on the street because there are gunfire after dark. I have to have metal on my porch because I'm worried about stray bullets. We live in fear because of guns. This guy was carrying a gun illegally in our community, in the city of Philadelphia. And that is something that legally the judge has to consider. The judge has to consider the interest of the public in sentencing. And we found that had an impact on the sentences we were getting. That in conjunction with getting higher bail for a gun arrest led to more people spending time in jail as a result of getting caught with a gun. And I think has had some positive impact. If for no other reason, it had maybe a good impact for the morale of the police officers, so that when they, again, risk their lives to arrest someone carrying a gun, that person's not back out on the corner 24 hours later. Whether it's 30 days, 60 days, or a year, it creates a deterrent that did not exist before in the city of Philadelphia for carrying a gun. And that's been a huge program that Ceasefire has done and brought the community into a partnership with the district attorney's office and the police in getting those better results. And getting back to the beginning, it gives us a something to throw back at the NRA when they say we don't need any other laws, just enforce the ones. We are enforcing the ones that exist, and it is not enough. And there are plenty of common sense ideas that would make it better. So take that argument off the table about enforce the ones that exist.
Great, thank you. I wanted Brian to be here to talk about how there can be this private-public partnership that we can work together, not just on policy, but on ways to take a stand, empower the community, and have an effect. If you're interested in ceasefire, let us know. We've brought it to Allegheny County. We'd love to bring it to other counties. It really does give people a chance to kind of take back their neighborhoods, to let judges and defense counsel and defendants and other people in the community know that it is no joke to carry a gun anymore in the city of Philadelphia. Brian Miller has been a leader in the movement for a long time. He is a predecessor of mine at Ceasefire PA. He was at Ceasefire New Jersey, and now he is the executive director of Heeding God's Call, and he's going to talk to us about partnership with the faith community. And I think as you'll hear as we go through that this is a joint coalition effort, and we're all, you know, so glad to be working together.
Indeed. Hi, folks. I've been doing this for a long time, almost 20 years. My brother was killed in 94 as an FBI agent working at a desk in D.C. police headquarters when a man walked in with an assault pistol, opened the door and opened fire and killed three law enforcement officers, and Mike was the first to die. I've been doing this for 20 years, and I'm tired of coming to these forums and educating folks, which is important. But I think we need to do more than we've done. And Governor Rendell said that earlier, but I actually think we need to do more than Governor Rendell says. I think we need a national social movement for change. So many people in this country want change about guns. They have begun to understand that we have it differently in the United States than the rest of the world, and we're tired of it. And we've been depending upon politicians to change things, and they've refused to do it. I think just as we change slavery and civil rights and so many other things, we need to bond together and force change in a major way. And we at Heeding God's Call, you might have noticed, it sounds like a faith-based group, and it is. We believe that the faith community can lead that change, as it has in almost every other social movement in the United States. So that we're trying at Heeding God's Call, in perhaps a small way in the beginning, to spark that change, to bring people out of the churches, out of the synagogues, out of the mosques, and into the street for action, for activism, for demanding change. And we do it by focusing local effort. And that's where the people are. That's where we need to bring them out. We started by focusing our attention on gun shops. You've heard a lot today about illegal guns. Fact is, the first time a gun is sold in the United States, it's sold by a gun retailer. Most of them are, and you heard John Lowy mention this, the bulk of them are good people. They see two people come in together to make a straw purchase, because that's typically how it's done. A trafficker comes in with his straw buyer, it's usually a man and a woman, and they're going to buy guns to put on the street. Most gun dealers see that coming up, and they're going to say, nope, I'm not selling you a gun, and I'm not, in Pennsylvania, I'm not selling you the 10 guns you want to buy. But some of them are willing to do it. Some of them are willing to take blood money to do it. And what we do at Heeding God's Call is we go talk to those gun dealers, we try to persuade them to adopt a code of conduct that the Mayors Against Illegal Guns developed, and we seek to get them to act as good citizens and stop selling and stop making blood money. The first place we went, not far from here, on Spring Garden Street, Colosimo's Gun Center, worst gun shop in Philadelphia, counted for 20% of guns recovered from crime. You heard the commissioner talk about how many guns that are recovered in the city. It's an amazing number of guns, and this one gun dealer was doing that. We talked to Mr. Colosimo, tried to convince him to adopt the code, and he said no. So we started doing once a week what we call witnesses in front of the gun shop. Sometimes we had 75 people there, sometimes we had 5 people there, but we're there for an hour during drive time, talking to people. There's a stoplight right there, so we had plenty of opportunities to talk to people, singing, praying, holding up our signs, educating people about gun trafficking and how it works and how it's very easy to understand if you hear about it. And after 9 months of doing that and Mr. Colosimo claiming he would never sell to a straw buyer, federal authorities then shuttered that gun shop and it's not been open since. Now it's a bike shop. I really like that. So we're two other gun shops in Northeast Philadelphia. We're at a gun shop right outside of Washington, D.C. No gun shops in D.C., so this one you can actually, in Maryland, you can actually see the D.C. border from the gun shop. And we work through volunteer chapters. We have volunteer chapters, five of them in the D.C., or excuse me, in the Philadelphia area. We just started a new one in Chester, a city that's totally devastated by gun violence. And earlier this week, we had a group of people out in front of that gun shop. He closed because he knew we were going to be there. We're not trying to close these people down. We just want them to be good citizens. But he's not selling any guns this past Tuesday that are ending up on the streets of Chester, so I don't feel so bad about it. But those activities bring people out, people that get involved. And these are people that can begin to work towards a movement for change in their communities and eventually larger than that. We also do what we call murder site witnesses. They're exactly what they sound like. We on Sunday afternoons, we come to a place where there's been a gun murder and we have an interface service. It lasts about 45 minutes. We pray, we sing, we people walking by stop and say, "What's going on here?" And more often than not, they join with us. And when we start with a crowd of 25 or 30, by the end of it, we have 65 or 75. All people now understanding gun trafficking and willing to do something about it. And we just this year started a new thing we call a memorial to the lost. We started at a church out in Chestnut Hill. We put a PVC pipe in the ground and make tees with them and hang T-shirts on them with the names, the date that they died, and the age of all 288 Philadelphians who died in 2012. 288 seems like a high number, I'm sure you agree, but when it's on a page or I'm saying it, it's nothing like walking through 288 T-shirts lined up in it like a graveyard. And we get people who just are driving by and stop, turn around, come back, and walk through our memorial. We move it around the city. It's been in five different locations, at churches and in a city park. And everywhere it goes, it creates inspiration and interest and commitment for change. So what I believe is, it would be great if we all became single-issue voters, as Governor Rendell said, but I find that hard to believe. But I do believe that we can work together. The faith community can lead, but it takes every other constituency to join in. But that's how national social movements begin and how they're sustained. And I think we can begin it here in Philadelphia. Thank you.
Thanks, Brian. I want to introduce Dorothy Johnson Spite, who's the director and founder of Mothers in Charge. And I'd like you all to know that for those of you who think that your work isn't making a difference, on January 1st, it was announced by the Philadelphia Inquirer that Dorothy was the Inquirer's Citizen of the Year for her work in gun violence prevention and with advocacy for victims and survivors, and she has been a great partner. But we are making a difference. People are noticing. So, Dorothy, tell us what you're doing.
Sure. Good afternoon, everyone. How many are moms or dads? Okay, quite a few of you. I am the mother of colleague Jabbar Johnson. He was 24 years old, my firstborn, and my only son. Colleague was shot to death over a parking space in December of 2001. Since that day, I have committed my life to making a difference on the issue of gun violence. He was a graduate of University of Maryland Eastern Shore, doing all the right things with his life, a fine young man, and ran into a very angry, out-of-control person who had a gun illegally. In May of 2003, in fact, this May will be 11 years. I'm tired too, Brian. 11 years, I started Mothers in Charge with a group of courageous women who had lost children to violence and decided that they wanted to be the voice for their children who speak no more. So for 11 years now, we have been on the front lines every single day working to address the issue of violence. We've had the pleasure of working with Shira Goodman. We go to Harrisburg with her. I remember the first time going to Harrisburg thinking, like, why am I here? Why am I asking someone to put in place legislation if a gun is lost or stolen, you report it? I mean, that to me was just common sense. You know, why wouldn't you report a gun if it's lost or stolen? But we're still on that fight. We're still fighting for those kinds of common sense gun laws every single day, and I'm proud to be a partner with her on this fight. And as Deputy Commissioner Kevin Bethel mentioned, every single day we're working with the Philadelphia Police and Deputy Commissioner Ross in the back. We have a commissioner that is very open to involving the community, working closely with the community. And these courageous women that I work with every single day are proud to be a part of this effort because, as I said, it gives a voice to our children who speak no more, but it also empowers us that we can survive the pain of having to bury a son or a daughter or a loved one because someone took a gun and took their life. It's a pain that never goes away. It's a pain that you wake up with. It's a pain that you go to bed with. And every single day at our office at 1415 North Broad, our phones ring off the hook for family members who've lost loved ones to senseless violence. And we do everything with those families. We support them in ways that I guess maybe only another person who's lost a loved one can do. But there are also women and folks that are part of our organization who haven't lost a loved one and don't want to. And that's why they support our work every single day. I have a quick video, do I? Okay, I'd like to introduce you to Mothers in Charge. It's very short. It's a piece that was done by the Early Show. They came from New York and interviewed Mothers in Charge about the work that we're doing and have been doing for the last 11 years. This is Mothers in Charge.
From CBS News, it's the Early Show. With Erica Hill and Chris Ratton.
Just ahead this morning, women who have lost children to unspeakable violence are determined now to help others avoid it. A pretty remarkable group of women.
We're going to visit the group called Mothers in Charge when the Early Show comes back right here on CBS. This week, we're looking at the people and communities that help define the American spirit. And this morning, we profile a group of women in Philadelphia who suffer the greatest loss a mother can face.
In a city where 85% of homicides are committed with a gun, and more than 80% of them by African Americans between the ages of 15 and 34, these mothers are doing their best to make a difference, channeling their grief into community action.
Do I have any volunteers? What we learned last week?
At this Philadelphia area foster home, concerned, compassionate moms are reaching out.
We want you guys to really learn life on life terms.
Teaching these kids about the consequences of violence.
If you look at the numbers, it's the youth that's killing other youth. So I think it's important for us to go honest with them because we know firsthand what it's like for somebody to take something from you.
You gotta always keep that alive.
Dorothy Johnson Spite is the founder of Mothers in Charge, a Philadelphia-based advocacy and support group for families who've lost loved ones to violent crime.
What prompted you to start this organization were the families that are left behind.
And their struggle each day to live after a tragedy like that.
I think it's really making a difference.
10 years ago, Dorothy's son, Colic, was gunned down over a parking space.
He's kind of the wind beneath my wings that gets me going and think he would want me to try to save another mother from going through what we're going through.
It's a sentiment and an inspiration shared by many of these mothers who also share the unthinkable pain of losing a child to violence.
No one knows the attachment of a mother but a mother. I carried my son for 9 months, but God gave him to me for 30 years.
Out of their shared grief has grown a sisterhood of support and an increasingly important voice in the community.
Some of the murders that we see in the city have a lot to do with retaliation. So oftentimes we get calls from mothers who give us information, you know, or will talk to us about a particular crime or something that's going on or concern they have in their community.
In the hopes that you'll pass it on?
In the hopes that we'll pass it on or come out and get involved. We do that.
which includes bringing inspiration to an unlikely place.
How many of you ladies are mothers?
At this Philadelphia prison, inmates are graduating from a program that teaches the virtues of good parenting.
I am changing, and I'm going to get my life together again.
If we could teach these women how to change the way they think, they could change their behavior, thus reducing their recidivism in and out of prison. Because if they're in prison, then who's raising their children? Now we have another child who's angry, another child who's going to be violent, another child who's going to pick up their gun.
It can be a tough part of the city.
Their efforts have been recognized by law enforcement and by the city.
They're doing work that, quite frankly, the city government is really not necessarily in a position to do. And they do it with authority because of who they are.
Because of their success in the community, Mothers in Charge are now working with students at Villanova University to develop a national educational curriculum.
It's not just a Philadelphia problem with the violence, it's a problem across the country.
But for all of the strength they find in one another and in their shared mission to end the senseless violence that took their children, the pain will never be far away. Is there ever a day when you wake up and you think, you know, I'm not sure I can do this today. It's too hard for me without Khalid. I just don't know if I can.
Many days. But by the same token, he is what gets me up in the morning.
And he gets you through.
He gets me through.
It's just an amazing group of women, led by Dorothy there. As soon as they hear about a homicide, they immediately send a card trying to reach out to the family to bring them in, because it does do so much for these families to know that they're not alone. And a lot of the women were very generous in sharing their stories, share their stories with us, and we have a number of them on our website at earlyshow.cbsnews.com.
So powerful, but so good to see them continuing to go on and do this work. It's a quote that it's kind of stayed with me through many years. I heard it years ago. Dwight Eisenhower once said, there's no tragedy in life like the loss of the child. Things can never go back to the way they were. And it's good to see them moving on the best they can.
Yeah.
Stay with us. We'll be right back.
Thank you. So we are on the front lines every day working to make a difference. There are far too many guns in our communities across this country. We have chapters of Mothers in Charge in San Francisco, LA, Kansas City, Atlantic City, New Jersey, and Delaware. We are organizing across the country because it's not just a Philadelphia problem. We've got to all come together. I never thought I'd have to bury my son. And I just want to say that I don't think any one of us is safe until we're all safe, so we've got to all work together. We really do. It's not just a black problem or a white problem or anything like that. We've got to find ways to come together and address this issue of senseless violence that is tearing up communities across this country. Thank you.
Thanks, Dorothy. Well, I think the ABA should be very pleased because I'm catching up time, but I am going to take a couple more of our minutes. So I'd like to, I know many of the folks in the audience, and I'm glad to see you, but I know the one question that they would have for each of the panelists is, what's one thing I can go home and do today? So, Dorothy, what would you ask the audience to do today?
Think of a way that you can get involved. I think we all have gifts and talents that we have that we can lend to this effort, to this movement, whether you're a teacher or educator or social worker or just someone who has time, who's maybe retired, and you have time that you can get involved. There are things that they can do by getting involved with Ceasefire. You know, legislatively, there are things that you can do, writing letters. There's also mentoring of children that we need to help children know that they're loved and help them with their anger and things like that. The children that we have that are at risk oftentimes are victims and perpetrators of violence. So we just got to find ways to get involved wherever we are. And it's something that each and every one of us can do.
Brian, same question.
I'd say to any people of faith in the audience to take the message that you heard today and take it back to your church or your synagogue or your mosque. Every one of them, or almost every one of them, has some sort of witness, mission, social action, whatever, committee. Those are perfect opportunities to get people involved in this issue. They're little groups that do actually do activism, and get them to push it up through the church or the whatever the community of faith. And then beyond that, to the regional body of whatever faith that is, as a way to get the faith community really involved in activism to prevent gun violence.
Brian Lenz?
Yeah, I would say one thing that I would recommend is to get really smart about guns. I think one of the biggest mistakes we make on this side of the argument is we don't learn the fundamental facts about the different types of guns, how they work. Not asking you to be, you know, go to a range or become a gun nut, but when you're going to have these debates, one of the big things that I observed in the legislative, at least in the legislative debate, is that oftentimes the people that are advocating for limits and restrictions don't have a complete understanding of the different types of guns, the different mechanisms, and it helps to be able to push back against the myths and the falsehoods that the NRA pushes if you educate yourself on that.
Commissioner?
I'll piggyback what Ms. Dorothy said, is just get involved. You know, I was a commander of the 17th District in South Philly, I met a young man in a fourth grade class and went to talk to him about guns, and we had a kid who had shot himself, and they asked him to come in and talk to him. And in that conversation, this kid got up out of the room and walked away and was crying. Didn't understand why. I followed him into the bathroom later on, and he talked about how two of his brothers were killed. And so I walked away from that environment saying, well, and I went back to the office and I said, wow, I got to do something here. I know I'm in the policing business, but what can I do as a man for a young man who seemed to be in so much pain? And so I called back to the school, and 7 years later, you know, I don't have a son. I got three daughters, you know what I mean? But I have a young man who's almost there. He's in 11th grade. He's a stellar student. He's a man of faith. He believes that what he needs to be doing. He goes on vacation every day. Imagine taking a 12-year-old on vacation if you had never been to the ocean.
Wow.
Imagine that. You know, I sat there sometimes watching through the lens of a young man who sitting there running in the sand and in the water who had never really been to the ocean. And so you start to realize the impact. And it hasn't cost me one dime. You know, man, it doesn't cost me. I have a son now who I love to death and who's made me a better person. And so I challenge folks who are in those positions, you don't know what you can do if until you reach out and touch someone.
That's right.
I mean, it does not get counted in the nightly stats. You won't see that. I mean, you know, but what you do will get will be somebody who, you know, you can sit back later on and tap you on the shoulder and say, hey, you know, thank you. You can sometimes you just can't find that. And so I every time I see somebody, and I'm challenging my officers now to make those positive contacts. I mean, you have to put a hand on someone. You know what I mean, and you many of you have experience in here that goes well beyond your years. I was a young man, and my godfather was in a cleaning business, and I spent 8 years in the cleaning business, and he taught me the business, and I couldn't understand why he'd make me just show up after work, and he would never drive me to work. He'd make me walk and meet him at work, but he taught me so many things, so many life skills that I can never repay him today. And so I would challenge you to push out there and really get involved and really just take some effort to really touch someone that you know or some kid that you see out there who's struggling, because you can never imagine the difference you could make in their lives.
Thank you. At Ceasefire PA, we're so proud to be partnering with all these groups, and we also like to say that we'll meet anyone where they are. If they want to host us at their church or synagogue or mosque, we'll come. If they want to have a small gathering at their house with their neighbors and start talking about it, we'll be there. If you are ready to come to Harrisburg with us, we will be going back as soon as it gets a little warmer, and I can guarantee that my buses will go. We're going to go. Send an email. But we're ready, thank you, to take those first steps with you. We know that not everybody is going to be able to come up. I can't do it what, you know, the public health folks did and John Lowy and Julie. We can't all be those experts, but you don't have to be. You have something better. You are a voter who lives in a district where somebody cares about it. And you can call them on the phone and say, I live in this district, and I want Representative Jones to know that I'm sick of the gun violence, and I want to change, you know, XYZ, our background check laws. I don't want it to be so easy to get guns. I want to know what you're doing about mental health. And that's all you have to do. And Brian can tell you as a former legislator that they write that down. Every call matters. Everything matters. You do not have to be an expert. You do not have to know all the facts. It comes from in here, like Dorothy and Brian talked about. And I know you all have that. And we at Ceasefire PA, at Heeding God's Call, at Mothers in Charge, we want to meet you where you are. And if I'm not the right person, I'll send you to one of them, and they'll send you to me. And we do programs together so that we can make our members, you know, fuller and broader participants in this. There's a couple questions.
Sure, can I also add?
Oh, please, yeah.
We have our second national conference coming up in May. May 11th through the 14th at the Sheraton Hotel. It's called The Cost of Violence. There's some flyers out on the table, so when you're leaving, grab one. This is also a way that you can get involved by supporting our conference. We have workshops and presenters and a lot of educational presentations and forums that you'll learn more about how you can get involved to make a difference.
Great, thank you. There's a couple audience questions. This one is for Brian Lentz. It says, I am one of those people who are ignorant about guns. Who might make a presentation to educate us? Are you suggesting that I just read? Where that's a good question. Where can somebody go to learn that and not be intimidated and get good basic information that will help them be more effective?
Well, I mean, you can do it by reading, obviously hands-on, to really get an understanding of how guns operate and the different, you know, revolver, semi-automatic, bolt action, et cetera. Those are things that you need to, I think, be conversant in if you're going to be an advocate or arguing with the NRA. You can go to a gun store, and, you know, they don't need to know that you're there for gun control. They'll show you all the guns because they think you're a customer. I'm sure Brian can tell you that. They'll put anything out there you want to see. You can go to a local rod and gun club. Same thing. They sometimes offer classes to people that they think are prospective members. Or if you have a friend or relative that happens to be familiar with guns or is a gun owner, you can do it that way. Those are some of the ideas. I suppose you could go to the police department and ask them to give you a class on it. I don't think that would happen.
Bring a gun with you, right?
Yeah, right. Yeah.
Well, maybe we can and convince. I know some of you might not want to go to the gun store, or I've done it, or to the range, but maybe we can convince the police in different counties to do some programs with us that are more for people who just want to learn, not for people who want to get a concealed carry permit or have the safety training, but who just want to learn a little bit about the laws and about guns themselves, and I'm happy to look into that. Brian Miller, can you speak about the Sunday devoted for all churches to mention gun violence? I think it's about gun violence Sabbath, maybe?
Yeah, I probably should have mentioned that before. The weekend of, two weekends from now, as a matter of fact, the weekend of the 15th and 16th is a National Gun Violence Prevention Sabbath weekend. This is the second year it's being organized, and it's beginning to grow. And it's a good thing. There's a website, GVP, I think Sabbath is the website, the organization, the main organization that's behind it is called Faith United to Prevent Gun Violence. And what we seek to do in this is basically get, as I said before, get communities of faith to focus on the issue of gun violence. Every faith tradition has the same thing, which is we are all responsible for our fellows. And that's at heart where the effort, the faith community effort to prevent gun violence, that's where it begins. So at that website, there are all sorts of resources for different religions and faith traditions, including prayers, hymns, and so on, sermons and so on. So that's a good, really good resource, and we hope to build it each year so that it becomes a truly national Sabbath weekend in the future. Thanks for that question, by the way.
Here's two questions about straw purchasers. So I think probably Commissioner and both Brian's. One is, why aren't more straw purchasers prosecuted, and also how do you identify the gun dealers who are more likely to be selling to straw purchasers?
Sure. Well, there is an entire unit in the Philadelphia DA/Attorney General's office devoted to prosecuting straw purchasers, so they are being prosecuted. Brian can tell you from his experience with different gun shops how you can just sort of, I think he would tell you from standing outside, you can sort of see whether a shop is really being strict in who they sell to and who not. In terms of guns that turn up in crime, you can track, you know, if one particular gun shop happens to be sort of a hot spot for having guns turn up in crime a short time after purchasing, if you take the time to collect that data, you can tell that. The main way that straw purchasing cases are prosecuted in Philadelphia are actually from tips from gun stores that are cooperative. So oftentimes, oftentimes retired law enforcement guys work in the gun shops, and you know, the classic stereotypical story is that the young lady who's 4'2" comes in and requests a 50 caliber Desert Eagle, And when she's asked what model, she looks at her phone and says, Glock. And he says, that usually tips them off that maybe she's not the actual buyer. And what they'll sometimes do is they'll delay the sale, notify the agents, so that the agents can actually, in some cases, actually be behind the counter when she comes back to pick the gun up, and then they'll follow the purchaser to whoever the felon who organized that purchase. That's a typical fact pattern. Those are prosecuted, but they're not prosecuted in any huge numbers because you only know about them, A, if you get that tip ahead of time, or B, if you recover the gun in a crime and there is some way to link it back to the fact that it was straw purchased. As Kevin said, most of the guns recovered are 5-6 years old. If they were straw purchased, it's almost impossible, virtually impossible to recreate that they were straw purchased 6 years prior, because by the time they recovered, they've been through two or three people, and there's no way to trace it back to that original purchase.
So let's, one final question for everybody is, this is the end of a long day, you know, it's been a little bit up and down emotionally. What's, you know, one thing you would say to keep people motivated, energized, that we will eventually have some success? Let's start with you, Commissioner.
I often tell people that we sometimes we don't give ourselves enough credit. You know, we have made success. I mean, the strides that you hear and the conversations that I heard in the back and the efforts are being put forth, I think sometimes we have to kind of take a step back and say the work that we're doing, the work that we will be doing is the right place to be. And I get up every day ready to go, and I'm sure most of you in this room do. You know, and I'm motivated by having living in the city and having three daughters and trying in my best to be in a position of a policymaker and deploying the assets across the city that we are making a difference. And so I would again just continue to tell you to keep pushing, that we are making strides, that we continue to have to chip away. But I've seen how the city has evolved. I've seen, you know, Center City evolve when it was, for those of you who knew Center City 27 years ago, and to see where it's at. You can see change can happen if people put their strengths and energies and direct it in the right place. Change can happen. I've seen the changes at the DA's office. You know, I mean, when they, you know, with different leadership and coming on and say we're going to be more engaged in what's going on and be more targeted and driven. And I see the activities, you know, particularly with Ms. Dorothy and the work that they have done and the evolution of that program and the men and women and the women that I've come to know through that program. So I just say continue to stay dedicated. Continue to give accolades to yourself for the work you're doing, with the understanding that, you know, if we drop the ball, then who do we pass it on to? You know what I mean? It has to be part of our legacy that, you know, someday sitting back in some corner somewhere, you're going to say all that work and effort you put forth did make a difference. And I think we can make that happen.
Yeah, I would just echo what Kevin said. You know, because of people like Kevin or Commissioner Bethel, because of people like him and the leaders in law enforcement, we're in sort of a golden age of law enforcement with many of the most cutting edge ideas about prevention and targeting and being data driven. Those are the reasons that they're seeing the dramatic reductions that they got in the past year. So there's real good news in the law enforcement community and the prevention community and the impact that they're having on saving lives. On the legislative agenda, you need a little more of a pep talk because certainly in Pennsylvania for the foreseeable future, it's pretty dim. But again, to echo what Commissioner Bethel said, we're right, they're wrong. And sometimes it takes a long time for the right side to prevail. But in most cases throughout our history, eventually the right side prevails. So I would say just keep making the arguments. This is a generational thing when it comes to gun laws in the state of Pennsylvania, but we'll get there, I'm confident.
Well, as much as I'm tired of doing this work, I'm actually very optimistic. I'm optimistic, and I'm optimistic in Pennsylvania even. I think just demographics is one big reason. When my father was growing up, it was very typical for fathers and sons to go hunting. Now, I have no difficulty with hunting, and neither does heeding God's call. But but it was creating the market for the National Rifle Association, if you will. When I was a kid, my father took me hunting, but he hated it. And I don't take my son hunting, I never would. And my 27-year-old son and his friends, they're not interested in hunting. And we've seen the hunting community in the United States drop dramatically, and that's why the gun companies have started selling guns on making them look military and matching them with video games and so on. But I think the NRA's market is shrinking constantly and dramatically over time, so that the people who support them become a smaller and smaller part of the population. And I know my 27-year-old son and his friends, they have no interest in guns, and that generation is really interested in gun violence prevention, I believe. So when I talked about the national social movement, it may sound a little dreamlike, but I don't think it is, because I think that younger generation is in fact going to lead it in the near future, and that's going to bring change completely across the country. And in Pennsylvania itself, I think that finally, you know, Pennsylvania had no gun violence prevention organizations until very recently, but now we do have organizations. We have organizations up here, we have Delco United and many other local organizations that have sprung up, and I think what we're going to see is they're going to work together to build campaigns, and it's campaigns that change things electorally and legislatively, and I'm really excited that we're going to be part of that, and I think we're going to bring major change in Pennsylvania, not in 20 years, but far shorter than that, so I think it's a good time.
I agree, Brian. I think that you've got to stand for the right thing, and right will prevail. It's difficult sometimes when we get the news reports, 6 o'clock in the evening, you're watching the news, but I think we are a part of a movement that is going to change, you know, the way that things are. And I have a 4-year-old grandson who's named after my son, colleague, and I might not be around to see when he's 22, 23, or 24, but I will know that I've made a difference, you know, not only for him, but for your grandchildren as well, or your children, that maybe they'll be a lot safer in the city of Philadelphia and surrounding areas because of the work that we're doing.
Well, thank you. And I would just ask you all, please, you know, get involved, stay heartened, sign up for our emails, sign up with Dorothy and Brian, come to something. And we're supposed to have a nice weekend this weekend, so that means, you know, it means politicians are going to be knocking on your doors because they need their petition signatures. I've been hearing a lot of them complaining that they're behind. Ask them. They're coming to ask you for something. Ask them, where do you stand on this? What are you going to do? How are you going to break the logjam in Harrisburg? That is easy. It is your right. It's your First Amendment right. It's number one in the Bill of Rights, right? So please do that. I want to thank the ABA, President yes. Silkenot, David Clark, all the panelists. I think they're going to come back up, but you've been a terrific audience. I'm so proud that we did this in Philadelphia. So thank you.
Thank you for attending. It's hard. One can't follow an act like this. You have a strong local group. There are things that can be done, as we've heard today. There are actions that can be taken. As Brian Lentz said, we don't have to just listen to the line, just go enforce the laws you have. Because we're doing that, there are things you can do. We don't have to listen when someone says everything about any restriction, any regulation, any legislation violates the Second Amendment. You can say, well, wait a second. We heard from constitutional scholars, we heard from others, citing the Supreme Court decisions, that's not the case. There are things we can do. There are moves that you can make. And then again, I guess it all gets back to, and maybe Governor and Mayor Rendell said it, and the others, all politics is local. You can make a difference here. Thank you so much for welcoming us, Philadelphia.